Hello, everybody. Welcome to Unscripted Access, episode number 179 on the Gamer Access. This is the E3 Sony and Microsoft press conferences impression special. Joining me today is Lord Bremenn Milan.
Yo.
And the head man himself, Nick McCandless.
What's up?
So we're in the hotel room right now. We just came back. And... well, we might as well start at the beginning of the day. Let's start with Microsoft.
Yeah, Microsoft.
Same place as usual, the Gallen Center.
Yeah, it's always been the same place from, as far as the times I've been going. I wasn't bored, I'll give them that.
Yeah,
but
we can start at the beginning with what they showed. Then the very first thing that they showed was...
the Xbox One.
The S. Yeah, the Xbox One S.
The slim version,
Which looks like halfway between an Xbox One Fatty and a non-italicized PS4.
Yeah, it's 40% lighter, and it actually includes the power supply inside, which is actually really nice. Cause
that's about
been a time. Big complaint with their consoles. It supports 4K video, not gaming, but 4K video, HDR. It supports up to 2 terabytes of storage.
Sounds good, but I feel like, and I told you guys this too, like I feel like maybe I should just wait for the Scorpio then, if that's the case.
Yeah, we'll get to that later, but yeah, I looked
at
that. Like,
start at $299.
Yeah.
Which is a not bad price. I would say it's kind of fair, right? Wouldn't you guys say?
I think it's more than fair.
It's a fair price.
If anything,
I just want to know what size storage that is, though. They didn't say that.
Yeah, Microsoft is like very aggressive with their pricing, so I think
they have to be.
I think it's a 500 gig. I think because,
I mean, I've heard from other friends of mine that they're like, well, yeah, the Slim. If there's really an Xbox One Slim out there. I wouldn't mind buying it. It looks nice. It's like I said, it's 40% smaller, right? Now they said 40% smaller than the original. And the power brick, thank God you guys went with the power brick being inside now.
It's about time.
Yeah.
They had to, because the Xbox One, it's such a gigantic system with an external power brick, and it's slower than a PS4, and you're like...
Yeah, and they also said that...
I understand that it's a quiet system, but that's, like, the only thing that justifies its size.
And they also said that the controller is a new design, right? The new design controllers.
It's revised. I forgot what they changed with it. Oh, they put Bluetooth in it now, I know that.
Which is good, I like that.
Which is great, because that means
range.
Which is kind of cool for like the PC people, because if you have a Bluetooth adapter on your laptop or PC, you no longer have to have a USB in order to attach your Xbox or a special adapter.
Those are good.
Anymore.
And I mean, those are going to be now, I think those are going to be the standard controllers now from here on, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they
should
be.
It's a minor revision. I don't know about the Xbox One regular, that may still sell for a small bit, but. Yeah, I think they'll come with regular controllers.
Yeah, it looks pretty nice. $299, not a bad price.
It's okay for people who don't own an Xbox One yet.
Yeah, if you don't own an Xbox One yet, this is probably the way to go. It's smaller, so you can bring it almost anywhere now. Because believe me, I travel with my systems, and I've always traveled with my PS4. Why? Because it's smaller, it's easier to pack. I don't have to freaking lug around an extra...
VCR player.
Yeah, or a power brick, plug-in.
Power brick on top of that.
Yeah.
That's always what I found annoying.
So now, with it being much smaller, slimmer, if I owned one now, I could actually bring it around now more often, So I wouldn't feel too bad, like, oh, damn it, why do I gotta bring my Xbox One? Well, now... with the new size and everything, I'm like, all right, well, I can actually do this now. It's possible.
I do, that is an awesome thing. I still think that's kind of like a very small minority, because I don't think people
travel. Well, I'm just saying for me, that's, my preference. But the specs look pretty good. Isn't it better than the original Xbox One? A little bit better?
I don't think they're making any significant...
It's just shrinking it. They say HDR.
HDR and 4K video support, so those are probably just changes with the output of the console.
Yeah.
I don't think they're actually changing the hardware. If they are, it's very minor.
I mean, you're still getting your the Xbox One. Just, you know, it's an Xbox One. It's just a smaller Xbox One with some minor tweaks here and there. You know,
it's just a cheaper manufacturing like size shrink.
Yeah,
it's like how the PS3 Slim was.
Yeah, but having the power supply built in is very nice.
Yeah,
that a long time.
That was a small feature that should have been like thought of like at the start.
One thing I wonder is if that new wireless controller comes out of the box rechargeable.
That
was really annoying.
They never mentioned that. You got a point. They didn't mention that.
I think
that.
If they
what?
Would have done that, they would have announced it. So, probably not.
Well, then that's pretty annoying because, like, Nintendo has figured out how to make a controller that supports Rumble that has 80-hour battery life and you don't have to charge it for a very, very, very long time. Like, Nintendo's figured that part out.
Right.
So it's like, why doesn't my... Like, how hard is it to put a rechargeable battery in? Because you sell an extra playing charge kit for $20 and you're already selling the controller and extra controllers for, like, $40 or $60 each.
They're about $60, yeah.
Each.
Yeah, that's just a huge... That's annoying.
It is, right? Like, you know, imagine your sales pitch. You're trying to sell the Xbox
2016.
One.
2016.
What's that?
It's freaking 2016.
Oh, yeah.
And we're not worried about the controllers not being rechargeable. It's like buying a cell phone and be like, oh, it uses AA batteries.
I'm sitting here and I'm like, how come battery technology doesn't seem to get that much better? Because, like, laptops still... Well, in the case of PC laptops, PC laptops are still stuck with, like, 4-hour batteries, which isn't really much better than the 3.5-hour battery that you got 6 years ago. It's like, what is it with, like, battery tech just kind of hitting a wall? And heck, we were like going around and all our iPhone batteries are dead.
In my defense, I did not charge my phone overnight, so.
Yeah, I used mine for GPS.
Oh, what else do we have on the, what was the next one?
So that was the Xbox One S. Now, the thing that I'm most excited about is they announced this whole initiative for Xbox Play Anywhere, which is essentially if you buy the game digitally on Xbox One or PC, you get to play it on either platform at no additional cost, and you get to play cross-platform. So if you're playing on PC and you have a friend playing on the Xbox One, you guys can play with or against each other, which I think is awesome because I have a high-end PC, and I want to play Forza and Gears of War and be able to use my PC to play these games, and I'll be able to do that, which is
and still be able
super
to play
exciting for me.
With your other buddies, too, who are probably on Xbox One, the regular, you know.
Yeah, for all the peasants. No, I'm joking.
Oh.
For all the people playing with... I'm joking.
Oh.
Oh, shut up, Anthony. You bought a 970. Don't even go there.
A bulb, like, it's... like computer that would cost like $2,000.
Anyway, so yeah, I mean I like that idea where you can
it's
play
like cross buy, but instead of being to a portable system that doesn't really get much sales, you're doing it with a game system and a PC.
Well, the thing I wonder about that is like there's got to be something where it prioritizes PC versus PC and Xbox One versus Xbox One. It must only do that if it's like a friend, because when it comes to like first person shooters, there's a huge disadvantage.
Oh no, I get it.
If you're
actually
using the mouse,
like
yeah.
When Blizzard released Overwatch, they actually said the reason why there isn't cross network play with the PC people is because the mouse gives an unfair advantage.
Right.
That's why if you were on the consoles, you can't play with the PC PC people.
Right, right.
The mouse gives that much precision, so.
Well, you know what? I can kind of see it with the PS4.
I mean, I can understand if it's like playing a friend, yeah, whatever. You obviously know what they're playing.
Yeah,
with.
But if it's like a
but
rank
if it's like
match,
going into like a random match, I'm sure it prioritizes Xbox versus Xbox, PC versus PC. I'm sure it only allows that if you're trying to play with a friend.
Or what they
yeah,
can
which
do.
Would still I mean it's yeah. I
that
like
or they
that.
Have to like bring keyboard mouse support to like the Xbox One also.
Which wouldn't be too hard, right?
They
that,
brought it with them.
That,
and
at least that would...
PS3 with some games. Like, Unreal Tournament 3 support.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So the old Final Fantasy games. Remember the Final Fantasy... 11?
Yeah, 11.
We'll do that.
It made sense, because how else are you supposed to type messages to people?
Yeah.
You didn't have voice chat
so,
built into the game, I don't
know. Xbox One, you know, I'm sure they could probably come up with something, right? I mean, it shouldn't be that
yeah.
hard.
I love Play Anywhere, because like I said, that brings a lot of, like... The reason why I bought an Xbox is Forza, and now that I can just play Forza on my high-end computer, that's fantastic. I don't have to, you know, take out my system out of the box. And heck,
yeah.
And heck, if I can have it on my PC, that means that if I have a strong enough gaming laptop, I just put Forza on my laptop and I can take it with me.
Yeah, and it's a one-time buy. It's not like you get
buy. It's like a cross-buy thing, as long as it's digital.
Yeah. That is the rule there, too, obviously.
Which, you know, I'm okay with, because my Xbox One is all digital games. I don't have a single physical copy of my Xbox One. Because I thought, my Xbox One, I only have it for like 3 or 4 games. So why would I want to...
This one here is a good thing. I like that idea. But I don't see any problems right now, you know. But the way it sounds, the way it looks, I'm saying, I'm on board with it.
I play Forza 6 Apex, and I don't think my computer is strong enough to run it because it has these weird stutters with it. But, you know, I could tell, like, yeah, Forza 6 Apex is kind of like an experiment to bring a console game engine to the PC so they can make Forza Horizon 3 and Motorsport 7 when that comes around. Stuff like that. But, you know, I'm really happy about the Play Anywhere, because that means, I don't have to buy an Xbox game console ever again if I, you know, have a gaming PC, which I do.
Yeah, I think it works in their favor, too, you know, like, in both ways. Like, they'll still make
Microsoft, they're pretty much just going to the point where it's like, yeah, they'll still sell hardware, because there's people that don't want to deal with PCs, they'll just buy Xboxes.
Yeah, they...
But they just want to prioritize and focus on software, and be like, yeah, we're building this for a custom PC anyway, why not put it on PC?
Yeah.
And then they'll release a new upgraded Xbox One every however many years, and that'll just be for people that want to not deal with the PC stuff, because there is inconveniences of dealing with a PC that you don't have to worry about with an Xbox. So it makes perfect sense. You know, we're kind of shifting away from the whole generational move.
Yeah, at this point, the generation thing could be... I can understand their logic. Generations seem kind of limiting. Because once the new generation comes by, you have to step up to new hardware and want to keep gaming with new games. Whereas what Xbox is doing, to me, kind of seems like the Apple model, where when they release a brand new operating system or apps, like, I have the brand new iPhone 6S. I could still play Infinity Blade 2 that I bought for my iPod Touch 5 years ago.
Right.
It plays it just fine, and I could, and you know, and it goes the other way too. Apple is, you know, continues to support the iPhone 5, which is like 4 years.
Well, they were supporting the 4S until they announced iOS 10 today. They're supporting a phone that was like 4 or 5 years old, which is crazy. I don't think Xbox will do that. I think like the current Xbox One will probably be phased out, and like new games coming out like 3 years from now probably won't support it.
Yeah, the Xbox One is actually not exactly what you call powerful these days. I mean, it like, to be honest, when I put this kind of a little bluntly, but the PS4 and Xbox One are basically glorified laptop processors, semi-custom laptop processors. They're not really exactly clocked very high. Yeah, they talk a lot about having 8 cores, but they're running at like 2 gigahertz each or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, stuff like that. But,
which for the price of them, I mean, you're not going to be able to build a PC that performs as well as these things for that price.
Yeah, try building a computer for like build a brand new computer for $300 that performs on the same level, that can play games that look like Uncharted 4. You can't.
Even come close.
Yeah, not even remotely close. But yeah, so Play Anywhere, that's exciting. That's cool, because it's good for the PC people, and for the Xbox console guy, well, maybe not so much that I know of. So
exciting for me. So Microsoft, not really surprised, but they announced Forza Horizon 3, which looks really sick. And I've always wanted to play Forza on my PC in 4K. So now I'll be able to do that with a fully fledged title. Yeah, there's Apex, but it's like a demo. So this is going to be like a fully fledged title for PC, which I'm really looking forward to. It looks really cool.
It's going to be in Australia.
Yeah, it was like super diverse, and all these vehicles.
It
and
seems very...
I was
kind of
surprised.
Seems
I was
even,
expecting to see bikes, but I could see them doing that as like an update.
It seems more and more separated from motorsport. As like the Horizon thing has gotten looks more separated from motorsport, because now it's like you're going off-road, you have these specialized off-road vehicles, you're jumping vehicles now, and then you're joining into other people's rooms and sharing the same world. It's quite a branch off of motorsport now.
Right.
To become almost its own thing. don't know, I think I played Forza and I was like, you know what, this would have been fun, more fun as a Horizon game, because I'm getting a little tired of driving around a racetrack all the time, and Horizon 3 totally solves that problem. you just take a vehicle and you toy around with it the whole time.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm super excited for that. So that's Forza Horizon 3. Then they announced the release date for ReCore. That game definitely seems interesting. And I remember they announced it last year. It's hard to tell.
Yeah, because they said, I think it was from the creators of Metroid, I believe, right?
Yeah, so they announced September 13th.
It looks interesting.
It looks like it has potential, but it's one of those games that we'll just really have to wait and see.
Not sure yet, yeah.
It's really hard to tell.
Yeah, it's one of those games, for me at least, it's like, yeah, it looks cool, but I don't know if I want to get it yet. You know, they have to show me something a little bit more than that. You know, I'm just assuming. Like, what I've seen in E3 so far, it looks like a platformer with all this other stuff that you can do to it. And I'm like, well, that's great. I wish you'd show me a little bit more. That makes me go, oh, okay, well, maybe I will play this. It didn't hit me that much, man. It didn't do much for me.
The style of the game doesn't exactly click with me, which is okay, because like a lot of game styles don't really click with me. But I also have a little bit of understanding the game's gameplay. So the footage show, because it was kind of more like introducing the characters or the mechanics than actually showing what you're actually doing.
Yeah.
So I got a little confused about what the game is actually about.
Well, yeah, I sort of get what like how things work with the way when you if you do play the game, because you know you can grab the core and use it and turn it into like your friend or something, you know. But I don't know. It just didn't grab me as much as you know some of the other games that I've seen so far. We'll just have to wait and see. We really do. That's all I can say about that.
So that comes out in September. So that'll be interesting. So Killer Instinct, they announced Gears of War's General Rom will be coming as a character.
They showed Gears of War 4 first. I think.
What?
Yeah, because then they showed
So they showed Gears of War 4. The gameplay they showed this year was a million times better than the gameplay they showed last year.
Gameplay
they showed last year was awful.
Yeah.
I like that there's a co-op. I like they're doing the split-screen co-op again.
Well, I love I'll be able to play it on a PC, too.
Now,
in DirectX 12 4K beauty.
I'm talking about being able to play with your friends, but okay.
Well, yeah, that's a great thing. I'll be able to play with all of you guys even though I'm playing on my PC.
Yeah, you get to play with all you guys, and you're going to keep telling us, oh, man, you guys should have totally bought this on PC. And I'm like, Nick, I get it, but I don't have a $2,000 budget to build a brand new system from scratch right now. Okay, as awesome as the 1080 is
right
now.
I wish it cost $2,000.
Is it? Yeah,
it's like $3,500.
Yeah, but that's because you upgraded it like multiple times now.
It looks good. Gears of War looks good.
The graphics cards are like $2,000.
I'm a little
confused. Yeah.
I'm a little confused. Is it like four main characters or three main characters? It looked like we did show three, right?
Including
in that
video. You got betrayed again. Shocker.
Oh, okay.
Well, in the end of the story, it's like, you got betrayed again.
Well, but mainly, though, I like what they did here, where they said, you know what, there's a lot of people out there that what if your friend doesn't have an Xbox One, you know, and you guys want to play co-op? Well, you can still play the split-screen co-op. You know, I like that. They still kept that.
Couch co-op, as Sony calls it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I miss those times too. Those days, you know,
those days when interacting with real human beings was a thing. No.
Yeah. Right.
Which, by the way, I think real life human interactions are going to degrade just a little bit further after watching the new features coming to iMessages. I'm just like, no. I'm just sitting there in complete disbelief and Nick's laughing the whole time.
I think it's great.
I think it's like, I mean, it's great if you use it right, but it has so much potential for abuse, but...
But the gameplay so far, the Gears of War, like
it's
Nick was saying,
of War.
It looks
it's
very Gears
of War.
War.
It's very Gears of War with more interactive environments
a little
and
bit, you know,
bigger
new,
dangers because
new weapons and all that stuff.
How did they? It's like how did they end up in that giant dust storm that's swallowing up the entire platform they're on?
Well, that was just part of the demo. I'm sure when you play through it, you'll know how they got there.
It's more Gears of War, which you know I know of a friend who loves Gears of War. Or
yeah, if you're
the
Gears of War fan, definitely you will like.
Yeah,
this
it looks like Gears of War, and then there's gonna be Horde 3.0 because like Horde mode in Gears of War 2, I did play a lot. Horde mode in Gears 3 was a lot better because it felt a lot less repetitive because you could purchase stuff and then watch the Berserker come in and ruin your day. Or and then there's Horde mode 3.0, which I'm curious what they're gonna do to make it better. Yeah, and then there was General Rom for Killer Instinct.
Which
I don't play fighting games. I don't play Killer Instinct.
Well,
so.
I play fighting games, but I'm not huge at Killer Instinct. Sorry, guys. I mean, I'm sure it's a good game. I like the old, you know, the old school Killer Instinct, but I just didn't get into this new one. And I'm not, you know, like I don't know. Even if they said that General Rom from Gears of War, I'm like, well. I was kind of hoping for, like, Marcus. You know?
Yeah.
General Rom has
anywhere to fight with him, though, because he uses a gun.
Well, I mean...
General Rom at least kind of has, like, that beast brutality
remember,
behind him.
Remember,
whereas Marcus would just, like, I have a chainsaw and a
national
shotgun.
But the Arbiter has a gun. Remember the Arbiter?
But the Arbiter also has a sword.
Yeah. And he
so
has
there's
so
at least
a chainsaw.
So that way you don't just stand
and
back
gun.
And just shoot a gun all day.
I'm sure they would have figured out something better out of it, you know.
But
anyway, but
then it wouldn't be realistic or true to Gears' character.
Ow.
There you go, see? Two piecing's a thing and
I mean, you know, people but for those who are excited about that, that's fine. You know, that's good. That's good for them. But that's not the fighting game I was excited for. What else was the other one?
So, then they announced DLC for The Division Underground.
Which I played The Division.
It's called The Division Underground. It's coming out June 28th.
I played The Division. I think it's fun. I played with a lot of friends. It's a fun game. I will play this one. I will definitely play this one when it comes out. So, for a lot of the Division fans out there that love the game, and I know there's a lot of you, you're gonna have fun with this one. It looks good. It really does look like a whole new challenging map.
They say no battle is ever the same.
What's that?
They said that no battle will ever be the same. So
yeah,
I've heard that one before.
Yeah, has that random. Well, that's what the video claimed. Okay, whether it's really true or not, I don't know. So that's what the promotion says. No battle ever be the same.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that there's a lot
actually
of
did they say
that
in the Battlefield 1 trailer also?
Did they? I don't know.
I would be surprised.
But I'm excited for that new Division because I want to play a different map. I want to play, you know, a different type of story or you know see what else is there. What else? What are new stuff they might have added? You know, sooner or later.
Right. Alright, so then they showed Limbo developer Playdead's next game announced was Inside, which is coming out June 29th.
I forgot what that one was.
Oh, it's some... was that weird, just... They just showed backgrounds. They didn't really show gameplay. They just showed, like, you know, little backgrounds here and there.
I don't remember that one.
Yeah, it was that...
That completely fell out of my memory, man.
Yeah, there's some people out there that have heard of this game and know it, but I'm not familiar with it either.
Yeah, it's like one of those low budget. It's one of those games. It was really quick. It's not like they spent a lot of time on it.
Yeah, they really did.
Yeah,
so it's really I can't say much about it either. So not much to work with there.
Right. Okay. So then they announced new features for Xbox Live. So the features they announced was the ability to listen to background music, the integration of Cortana, and language region independence.
Yeah,
they also announced three big new features. So, creating clubs, looking for groups, and arenas.
Okay, so...
Background music is huge.
Background
music
is huge.
Although the 360 had that.
The 360
had
that.
Yeah, I know, right?
Dude, that was... here's the thing. I can't tell you how awesome it was to have background music that I play whatever music I want when I'm stuck in a 45-minute Forza Endurance race. It made it felt so much better. And I did some really stupid shit, like played my own... epic background music during all those cheesy big scenes in Oblivion. And then I never used it ever again.
No, but that's big for a lot of gamers. For
it's
a lot
big,
of players,
yeah, like,
you know. You want to be able
it's
to
just
listen
that
to
now
music.
It's just that nowadays not everyone has a phone. You can just play music straight off your phone. So, actually, if you could, like, Bluetooth connect your phone to your Xbox One and, you know, link up music that way instead of having to put it on the flash drive, that would actually save a lot of work
and
make the
feature
more usable.
Well, there's little, you know, little hiccups here and there.
Just
but
a suggestion.
You,
it's a suggestion.
Yeah, I know, but at least they're giving you that option now to actually be able to play your music, you know, on your system, on your Xbox. I like that, which means for me...
Yeah, you can kind of do it on your PlayStation 4, but you have to use Spotify to do it.
Yeah, see, I it's funny, right? Like, the Xbox 360, you'd be able to do that. PlayStation 2, right? I think it was 2? 2 or 3? You'd be able to do the...
So Xbox 360 was the first one to do it, and then they added it later on to the PlayStation 3.
Yeah, and then the reason why I like that, because the plus for me was, because I'm a big wrestling fan... When I would play a WWE game, if I created a character, guess what? I put my own intro music in there.
Right.
You know, stuff like that. It made it, you know, fun, and you can actually use, just, like, be more creative with your stuff. Now, with this one, maybe? I'm guessing? But that's a big deal for me. That is, to put your own music in, like, be able to listen to your own music while you're playing your game.
It's not as big for me as it used to be, but I could totally see it. Like, especially those long runs. Like, if you have any, like, the long grind, custom soundtracks really help. It's just that, like, again, we now live in an age where everyone kind of has a phone that has music on it. So I think if you could do Bluetooth connection with your phone for music, that would save a lot of work, because that means you don't have to put it on a flash drive to plug into your Xbox.
They didn't really dive into it as much, did they, right?
I know, but like I said, it's just like, do you really want to... turn on your computer and then plug in a flash drive to put music on, and then plug it into your Xbox One.
I have
like
seriously
old,
done that before.
Like, yeah, that was the old days. Why not just like do what a car does, which is Bluetooth connect to the device and then get your music off your phone?
No,
that way.
I understand
that,
I'm just that type of person. I've done that.
Yes,
like,
I've done it too.
Do
everyone
just
did
to get that shit going.
Yeah, I did that on my 360 also. Heck, I plugged a iPod in. It was an older iPod. That's how I...
Yeah, I mean, I even worked on just customizing the timing of the music so I could put it in certain games.
Yeah, I did that too, actually.
You know what I mean? Like, you would cut out the first...
But then you have to, like, pop up in the guide and make sure you hit the play button correctly, or else you fumbled up the scene.
What was the other one? The Xbox Live?
So background music, Cortana. Which is pretty much Microsoft version of Siri.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you already talked to your Xbox One anyway.
Here's the thing that bothers me about Cortana. Okay, Cortana actually... Cortana is a character from the Halo universe. In Halo 4, she went crazy and was supposedly killed, as far as I know. And then Halo 5, she comes back and is now the villain. And she's also your search for Windows and Xbox.
So
I'm sitting here and I'm thinking, I don't think the people who integrated Cortana into Windows and Xbox realized what the Halo team did with her, which is make her evil.
Oh, so you're thinking like Skynet from Terminator.
Yeah, it's just like, I don't know if that's good as if the Windows team realized what they were getting themselves to do when they decided to make the pretty, you know, it's like, well, we'll use Cortana.
I know,
right?
Because
that has connections to Halo. She has the prettiest voice out of Google and Siri.
Can you imagine like the VR, you know, for Xbox? Like, yeah, how you doing, Cortana?
HoloLens.
Sorry.
There
HoloLens.
You go. Yeah, HoloLens. I'm surprised they didn't talk about it this time. They did for
2 years,
actually.
Yeah, actually, that is odd. They never
talked about
it. I was
surprised about that, too.
Yeah.
Because they've shown it the last two times, and it was like one of their big secret projects that go into a military underground bunker. But
the
no.
club, I like that idea. I mean, I think it's pretty cool. If you find people that like the same stuff you like.
Sony also had that with
called
Communities, actually.
Well, no, I'm just saying, like, because we're on Microsoft right now, we're on Xbox, so, you know, I like that. I like the arena, because if you really want competition, you can actually, like, find people that may be better than you, or get...
Oh, looking for a group?
Yeah, or looking for a group and all
looking for competent Halo players that don't suck.
See, that's the best part that I
like.
Yeah,
the group
that.
Thing is really cool.
Yeah.
Also, you have to be careful about the group thing, because it is also a platform for some spam. I wouldn't say, like,
well,
obviously I'm sure that they'll have some spam filter.
Yeah, anything. There's always something can be abused.
Yeah. Let me tell you this, though. As a Division player, there have been many times where my brother and I would be like, you know, we want to do this mission, we want to find extra help, and it's like, god damn, it takes so damn long to find some damn help, you know, and that right there will is a good sign. I think that would help a lot of people, you know. You find the right
looking
people,
for someone to team. Play Forza with, because like one of my problems is that whenever I play Forza online, there's not that many people, or they're too crazy good, so I'm just like, I just need some guy to chill out.
How about this? How about, remember like when we used to play Grand Theft Auto, and we're like, god damn it, why do we have to keep, you know, why does the heist have to have four people? We gotta find the damn two more people.
We did talk about that too. It would be nice to have AI help us out. Yeah.
So this time, that I think would be very helpful, because then you can actually go, all right, finally, we can get like the four people, we can actually do this heist. We can't just sit in the damn waiting room waiting for somebody to fucking join. Sorry for my language. But this is unscripted, so, but yeah.
Unscripted doesn't mean...
Sorry, it just slipped out. It slipped out.
You mix up the word a little bit here. It's unscripted, not uncensored.
Uncensored access.
Uncensored access.
That would just lead to terrible places already.
What was the other one about the live?
What do they mean by language?
Oh yeah,
that language thing. I'm a little confused. They can send it to any language, no matter where they live.
Does it mean like I want English speaking people only? And then they
I'm confused about the language.
The language, I'm trying to remember what they mean by that. I'm looking that up right now.
It's like no matter where you live, something about language, no matter where you live. It's like, what, if you live in the US, you can't change it to French?
Mm-hmm.
Was that how it used to be? That makes no sense. Like, I didn't understand that one.
Yeah, well, honestly, it didn't really give a lot of explanation to it. Now that I think about it.
Yeah.
It was just like, well, now you can do this. I'm like, well, alright.
Oh, well, no, all it's talking about is, like, if you're in the United States and you prefer to speak Japanese,
you
can have everything set to Japanese now.
Alright. Well, I mean, I guess that's cool for a lot of people. That
very small amount of people, but
yeah, of course. It's not for a lot.
Well, it is a requested feature. They said they were features that were requested, right? So clearly they had feedback, and that's why they put the feature on, unless they wouldn't have, you know, even bothered.
All right.
So they have to have a number of people. Like, the communities thing, yeah, I could see that as a feature that people want, because it's just like, we are the professional Halo Club or something like that. That would make sense. Or, you know, Forza Club. I would actually join that one, actually. If they made, like, a Forza Club, and, you know, I just join in and learn how to tune cars to make them go faster, by all means, I would like to do that, too.
Yeah, what if they all talk in French?
The French Forza Club, they should have called it then. Let's see, what's the other three things they said?
For Xbox Live, there's the ability to create clubs, look for groups, and then there's the arena.
Okay.
I think we already kind of covered it already.
I think the arena is... The arena is great if you had more multiplayer. If it was a local... I noticed that arenas tend to be most common when you kind of have a big party going on.
Yeah.
You don't want to set up a tournament in the room. This is especially true with like Smash Brothers, which is why it kind of sucks that Smash Brothers doesn't have a tourney mode, because Bronson tried to run one. He had to find a bracket generator online.
That's mostly what arena is. It's for people who want to, you know, challenge other people, PvP, stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, that's what it is. Like, especially for the Dark Souls players out there that want to do PvP, that'd probably help them too. You know, so that's for a lot of people like PvP. There you go, arena, finally challenge. There you go,
sweet. So that's Xbox Live. Oh, they're putting out more servers, but
arena seems pretty cool.
Yeah, for the competitive people, that will work. That would be nice.
Yeah, I think they're making a move towards this whole esports movement going on,
which is good. I mean, you know, why not? That's how they're already
freaking
doing.
Considering the ridiculous prize pools that keep showing up, yeah.
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 You want to test your skills?
Yep.
What was the next one?
Cool. cool. So the next one they announced, customizable Xbox One controllers. So they have a website where you can go on and you can order customized controllers.
They said any kind of design, right? I wonder how.
Well, just you can pretty much
colors.
Change the colors.
It's
colors. I'm surprised
it's not like they're gonna do like an etching of, you know, custom artwork. I don't think they're gonna do that. That would be too much.
Well, that was the first. You know what? Funny. That's the first thing that came to my mind. Like, look, if I can customize my own controller, guess what? I'm drawing a picture on that fucking controller.
Yeah, but you as an artist would do that. But
yeah.
For most people. Actually, a lot of people think that, but at the same time, that would be a nightmare for the machine that makes the system.
Yeah,
that paints
I know.
With...
Well, that's why I'm surprised they did it for controllers, but not the consoles themselves.
Yeah, I would like my
so
console
hard.
To come in some and come in more than two colors.
But they do allow you to put your name and stuff on the controller, something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, they allow you to etch the name, which is pretty cool. So, that's that little piece.
Yeah, I know.
Like for
they
me,
announced that The Witcher 3's card game, Gwent, is getting its own game on both.
Oh yeah, they had an indie showing, yeah.
Yeah, it's coming to Xbox One and
so,
PC first. That's the type of game that they have to put that on iOS. It's like a mobile...
Hearthstone.
Yeah.
Because Hearthstone's available on, like, you know, PC, but where do people mostly play it? On the go.
Yeah.
Because it's a game
it's
that
a
you can...
It's a mobile type... It's a card game.
Yeah. For those who love that particular game,
I don't understand.
That's great.
I don't understand Gwent, because, you know,
yeah,
I lost pretty badly.
My confession is I never bothered to play Gwent in that game. The entire time was all about, like, Witcher hunting.
I played Gwent.
Monster hunting or whatever.
See, what happened is I stopped and played Gwent for, like, tried to learn Gwent for, like, a good 10 or 15 minutes, and I'm like, yeah, I'm pretty bad at this, and then gave up.
Yeah, I just gone in Gwent.
Yeah,
I the thing was that it does actually try. One thing I noticed is that it does actually make people to get, at least give a small effort to Gwent because they're stuck there for like 10, 15 minutes.
Well, I mean,
they
would not have made the game because remember they said, like, yeah, there was a lot
of. Oh, there was a huge fan base for that
yeah,
game.
So,
yeah, so. Remember reading, there was a huge fan base for that card game.
Yep.
So for those who love Gwent, there you go.
It was hard. It was actually a hard card game because freaking some guy could just play a card that changes the battlefield and. You could be screwed because of it. That's a pretty smart one.
Yeah.
But, CD Projekt Red is actually an independent developer.
A good one, actually.
Yeah.
What else you got?
So, they announced Minecraft Realms.
Yeah, don't...
Which pretty much allows... It's pretty much allows cross-platform, so Xbox One, Windows 10, iOS, Android can play Minecraft together.
Yeah, but they didn't say Windows Mobile either.
Yeah,
you brought that up, and like the guy did play on his Surface, but a Windows Surface runs Windows 10.
Yeah,
so that's
really
why. It's like you bought Nokia.
Can't the Surface
like my Surface
PC apps?
Wait,
yes,
you talk about
no
Surface
the
Surface
no.
So it may not be Windows Mobile.
No, it's not Windows Mobile, but it's Windows 10. The guy was playing on a Surface, so that's not Windows Mobile.
Well, that's what I'm saying is like. Okay, yes, iOS, Android, I get those are the big ones, but this is, Microsoft bought the damn company.
They bought Nokia.
And you're not even, you're saying, oh, iOS, Android, and nothing for Windows Mobile?
Windows Mobile is so under, nobody uses Windows Mobile to the point where even normal apps like, you know, Blizzard Authenticators can be downloaded on them because nobody uses a Windows phone.
I get it, but when you're the company that owns this
I know.
Shit, you own this and you're promoting the fact that every mobile platform
is it really
besides
that,
yours.
Is it really that hard to get to run on Nokia Lumina that you guys have been working on for the last 3 years?
Like, oh my gosh, that's like the biggest like slap in the face.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at Minecraft, it's really not graphically. It's not exactly
graphics.
You know,
it's a bunch of cubes.
No, that's what I'm saying. It's not exactly. You know, you wouldn't. I don't think you'd have a freaking hard time putting that in a freaking. You know,
they bothered to make it for the Wii U, so why not Windows Mobile?
Let's put on every platform, but our mobile platform.
Yeah.
Why would we do that?
Yeah, no, they only bought Nokia for the theater.
Spent the best theater.
Yeah, I know. It's in downtown LA, so why not?
So that's Minecraft. Then they showed gameplay of Tekken 7 and announced it's coming early 2017.
Oh, baby.
It's kind of cool.
Baby, that right there is my game. Tekken 7.
Yeah, we're going to be getting hands-on with Tekken 7 on the show floor, so we'll be able to report.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I'll definitely be on that one. Jeez, it looks awesome. I mean... For a lot of Tekken fans out there, you know you've been waiting for this. For people who are able to play it in the arcades, good for you, not so much for me, because I never found one. But now I'll be able to play it, you know, on the floor today, tomorrow. And then also, just seeing what they showed in their, you know, in that little demo that they showed, dude. It's from, like, you're playing the story mode, like, everybody who's played Tekken knows about the cinematic story modes. But this time, you actually, it's seamlessly just, you know, from the cinematic, you can control a little bit of it, and it goes straight to the fight. I'm like, wow. Before, in the old days, you know, you would show the cinematic, and it would load it, you know, and then you wait for to load the fight, and then you fight. Not this one. This is just like, you know, bam, bam, as soon as it just, everything is just seamless. And that's... For me, especially, because I, you know, besides the game Tekken itself, I like the story part of it. So, you know, it looks damn good, especially with Akuma being in there from Street Fighter. It kind of tells me, I don't know, maybe for me at least, it gives people the idea of like, well, if we put Street Fighter versus Tekken again, this is kind of how it would look like, you know, if it was the Tekken guys that built it.
Right.
Instead of the Capcom one, which, I'm sorry guys, I don't like the Capcom version. But the Namco version, if they make a Tekken versus Street Fighter, it's a Namco version. That's what it's going to look like. It's going to look freaking awesome. Anyway.
Sweet.
Notice it was just me that was talking
you
about
lost
the whole
me
time
on
for Tekken.
A lot of the fighting game stuff. Right
exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, so we'll have more to report on that once we have our appointment with Bandai.
Oh, yeah.
To get hands on with that. They announced Dead Rising 4. I've never really been a big fan of Dead Rising.
Yeah, my brother
wasn't
loves...
that the one I fell asleep in once?
No, that was that game Sony announced in the press conference that still hasn't come out. They announced it 2 years ago. It's a multi-plat. Oh, God, what's that called? It's a zombie game, but it's not Dead Rising.
Dead Island, yes. Yeah.
But anyway... Yeah, for those who like, and I know there's a lot of.
Oh, I remember that game ended up getting they like froze development because company filed bankruptcy or something like that.
So it was okay for me to fall asleep.
Anyway, going back to Dead Rising, a lot of people that played Dead Rising, and I know there's a lot of you too that enjoy this game, because you know it's like funny to just like wreak havoc on zombies with like. You know, whatever weapon you can find and whatever weapon you can build.
It's kind of hard to, like, do innovative things with zombie. Because that's...
How many
games have I seen now?
Okay,
three?
But hold on. There's a lot of people that are, like... There's a lot of people that are fans of the zombie games.
Oh, yeah. Zombies,
like,
zombies are a multi-billion dollar industry.
Yeah, so, you know... But anyway, my brother plays those games and, like, he likes them. I never really bothered to play Dead Rising, but if this one has the co-op in it, I mean, I might be willing to jump in and just help them, like, recap. It looked like it was co-op on that one, actually. So, you know, it looks like, I don't know if it's going to be just 2-player or 4-player. It'd be great. Just, you know, for people to play with their friends and wreak havoc and just, like, you know, tear apart some zombies. Zombie guts everywhere. But that's pretty much all I can get out of that game, though. That's all I can get out of that game. It's kind of like Dynasty Warriors. Like, oh, just wreak havoc, and then I'm done.
One man army.
And what else we got besides that?
So they showed the gameplay and announced co-op, and it'll also be coming to PC for Scalebound.
That was that
type of game.
Man, I wanted to like Scalebound because dragons and all that stuff, but it was, believe it or not, that was the only thing that felt boring.
Alright, to me it's Dragon May Cry.
Dragon May Cry.
Okay. Wow. Ouch.
Dragon May Cry.
Yeah.
I can see that, yeah.
That's what it is.
I can see
right?
that. Yeah.
The guy almost looks like Dante in some ways. Yeah. The
dialogue is almost Dante bad.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it's Dragon May Cry. Except, you know, with multiplayer.
Dragon May Cry. Oh, man. You're making it sound like Dragon's sad now.
But... trying to make it sound like Devil May Cry.
Yeah,
but yeah, I know.
The Dragon May Cry. Dragon May Cry.
Not much to say about it for me too. I mean, the boss battle looked good, but
the thing is like with Platinum Games, it's like they usually kind of go between okay and awesome, and like Platinum Games tend to be flawed unless like some Platinum Games like generally they're the pattern is that they tend to be great or a giant spectacle, but they're also flawed. Like, the Wonderful 101 is absolutely amazing, but it also has some, like, pretty noticeable flaws. Yeah. Bayonetta 2 is just crazy awesome. And Star Fox is a good Star Fox game, but the controls butchered it.
It's
so
like hit or
like
miss with those guys.
Yeah.
You know, but then again, you know, like, maybe this is like, they said gameplay, multiplayer gameplay, or co-op gameplay. Maybe it's still an early stage. Maybe. You know, it looked good for
I know, but to
graphics
me,
sake.
Yeah, but to me it just kind of looks like, just walk around, hit it, and stab its heart out.
Well, I'm hoping, the redeeming factor for me is I'm hoping that's just that boss fight. Just that particular boss fight.
But
if that's the
highlight
game,
that they choose for E3, I'm not.
No, no, but I'm saying is the rest of the game hopefully is not as, like, as that one.
That was the only boring part of that whole conference for me was Scalebound. Which I want to like that game, but
yeah, there's still a part of me that tells me, like, kind of, you know, convincing me, like, well, you never know, like, maybe the whole meat of the game is still good, you know, maybe it's just that one boss fight.
Yeah.
Because they did say that's the co-op part of it, so yeah, we'll see.
Don't play with people. Got it.
Was that the last one?
No.
That was a lot more. No.
Yeah. So they announced State of Decay 2 coming in 2017.
My brother loves that game too.
Never played State of Decay.
It's another zombie survival game though. It's more of like think of it like kind of like The Walking Dead, but a video game Walking Dead, where, you know, you play these characters or a certain character, and then you'll have to learn. And it literally is survival. Like, you know, you gotta make sure you have food, supplies, save people here and there that need help. You know, so that's what it is, at least as far as I know. But I mean, it looked like a fun game. I like that it's a open world thing where you can, you know, drive around and, like, hit zombies with certain vehicles, or, you know, that's all I got out of it. Sorry guys, that's all I know about that game. I've only seen what I've, you know, watched
from my I'm not into the zombie games.
Me either.
And what was the other one?
So then they announced Halo Wars 2.
That's all you guys. I don't know that.
That is not me.
Nobody really knows Halo Wars because it's an RTS, not a shooter.
I knew that
the original Halo Wars was the last game Ensemble Studios ever worked on before they closed.
Well, you play like Age of Empires and stuff, right? And kind of
I know,
same?
Yeah. Well, sort of, yeah. It's an RTS game. I just played the demo, and that was like freaking 7 years ago.
For people who like those type of games, I guess you'll like that one.
Apparently, they introduced a new thing to the entire Halo universe with that game, so, you know.
You know what's funny, too?
Did they change directors at 343 Studios? Because I thought a lady ran that studio. And now the director is a dude. So I'm like, did they have a change of staff at some point?
Well, the funny thing about that was the first time I saw the trailer, like a little bit of the beginning of it, I was thinking like, oh, is this Mass Effect?
I knew it was not Mass Effect because I kind of knew, I know a little too much about how that game looks, how that world looks.
That's what ran through my head.
Well, it's sci-fi uniforms because it's like, yeah, it's not Mass Effect because the armor doesn't look anything like
it. Well, no, because when they showed the bad guy that was walking, it kind of looked like one of them characters from Mass Effect. I don't know.
To me, it didn't. That's why it was kind of like a stand.
All right. Sorry. What was the next one after that one?
So we saw more gameplay for Sea of Thieves.
Which, I still have hope for this game.
It looks like it has a lot of potential.
Yeah, I still have hope for this game. I think it's going to be fun mostly when you play with your friends or play with people.
Oh, yeah, this is a game you have to play with
your friends. Yeah, because you're a whole crew of pirates and stuff, you know. So that looks like it's going to be fun. They only showed, like, how you, like, you know, manage
your ship. Yeah, all I saw was a bunch of people playing with their little webcam in the corner and trying to keep their boat from sinking.
Yeah,
while trying to sink other people.
Yeah, there's ship battles and stuff. They didn't show most of the stuff that you can do, but it looks promising. It does.
Yeah, I wanted to see it more like attacking other boats, not like working together to keep your boat from
sinking. Yeah,
The boat is sinking because it was in combat with other boats, if you recall.
Yeah, but they didn't show that.
They did. The two of them were fighting, and that's how it started sinking.
You know what they didn't show that you could, that I wish you could do that that I hope.
Well, they spent more time focused on how to keep your boat from sinking than combat. I'm more focused
then
on the combat
than learning how to fire a cannon. Yeah.
No, I mean, well, I wish they would have shown us something like, you know, like remember in Assassin's Creed Black Flag, where you can like swing off the, you know, off to another, to the other side of the boat, or to the other boat or the other ship. You can get off your ship, swing there, and then get on the other ship, and then, like, you know, the old pirate thing where you're swashbuckling and all that stuff. They didn't show that you could do that, so I'm hoping that, you know, somewhere around there they're going to add that.
Pirates make their return for this Uncharted 4, and now it's going to be Sea of Thieves.
I know, it seems to be a pirate theme here.
Captain Avery.
Take it easy.
So then Microsoft closed it out with the announcement of Project Scorpio,
yeah,
which is pretty much the next Xbox One, which will do 4K gaming, supposedly. Well, it has 6 teraflops of processing power, 8 CPU cores. They didn't announce, they said it's coming out holiday 2017. They didn't announce specs or price or anything like that.
But
so pretty much what, and it's just how the gaming industry is going, rather than doing generations, it's just gonna be upgrades.
Like
these Xboxes and these consoles are just custom PCs.
Well, it's like the Apple model. Like, for example, it's like your Apple, like, you may have an older Apple device, but you can still run everything the new devices can until the support drops on it. Like, I used my iPod Touch for like a good 2 years before I finally couldn't use any of the new apps anymore because my iPod Touch was lacking certain features.
Well, like I said from the beginning of this podcast, I'm like, well, I think, you know, that's probably what I would wait for me at least. That's what I would wait for. Like, well, yeah, there's the Xbox One Slim, but after hearing that, well, you know what? I'll just wait for that to come out then. I don't need the Slim that badly.
I do want to point that when they say 6 teraflops of power, every time when it comes to teraflops, that's like, apparently that's like the easy go-to horsepower number. It's like, okay, we're going to use teraflops as a relative comparison. The thing is, teraflops is like a theoretical number. Is it really going to reach 6 teraflops? Maybe only if you have a highly optimized benchmarking program, but, you know, realistically, it's probably going to reach about 5.5 or 5.8 if it's really good. But I don't think it's a hit 6. It's like when Sony came out and said, oh no, we got 1.81 teraflops power, and then NVIDIA came out and said, no, we got 10.
So you guys are saying now is...
Well, yeah, they're saying, oh, we're hoping to be the most powerful console.
Yeah, we believe.
We believe
this will be the most powerful console.
They
don't know what Sony... For all I know, Sony could just come out and say, PlayStation 4.5 will now come with 16 cores and, you know, a Titan X as a GPU for $200. They could just do that, but Microsoft says, we believe. So, yeah, they leave themselves a way out so they don't get laughed at.
But for what it's worth, they're trying. You know, you're right. They didn't announce a price for that one. So that kind of worries me.
It's Project Scorpio. It's still too early.
Uh-huh.
You don't know because first you have to, like, talk to your, like, manufacturer. Like the manufacturer of the product, be like, okay, well, how much is it going to cost to produce a unit of this in bulk? Like, if we produce like 100,000 units, how much is each unit going to cost wholesale? And then they have to figure that out, and then figure out a retail price from there.
Yeah. But
so, like I said, they don't even show like what the case looks like. They just show what the internal parts may look like in some 3D animated.
Yeah, it looked like it had a freaking full-size GPU so imagine the size of this
yeah.
Monster.
I'm gonna spoil it for you guys. It's gonna look like the PS4. It's gonna be shaped.
It's not gonna be that small. I don't know about you, but
it's gonna be like a double VCR.
Yeah, it's gonna go back to, well, look, well, it's just like, congratulations, you shrunk the Xbox only for it to get big and fat again because you needed 6 teraflops of power and you threw in a GPU cooling solution. Because that fan they showed in 3D animation looks suspiciously like a stock GPU reference fan.
And then the power brick's going to be outside again.
Because you couldn't fit a 150-watt power brick inside your system, so it has to be external again.
Oh, let me guess.
Return to form, right?
And let me guess. There's more. The controllers will still need freaking batteries.
I was in the Project Scorpio.
You spent all that
with
money
with all this power for 4K gaming.
You spent all this
at the
money.
Price of $7.99.
You spent all
and
that.
We're proud to announce our new and upgraded battery packs. Not included.
You spent all of that money and development on teraflopping power, and you don't put rechargeable batteries in your controller, whereas Nintendo and Sony have already figured that out a long time ago.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Well, you know.
Oh my goodness, everything's a rechargeable battery.
Like, yeah, I know. Like, do you they seem to be the only... the only ones that were the
did Duracell have a deal with them that says, look, we need to keep selling Duracell to AA batteries, and the only way we're going to keep selling them is to have your controllers keep eating them up, so please don't put a rechargeable battery in there. Is Duracell lobbying with Microsoft for that shit or something?
Well, the funny thing about this is, because remember, it took them a while before they said, when they announced the new Xbox, they're like, oh yeah, the power brick's going to be built in now. So I bet you the Scorpio's like, oh, guess what? Now we have rechargeable batteries in them. Oh, great! Yeah, welcome to the future!
It's like, and everyone is...
And we're proud to announce our controllers now ship rechargeable.
It's like we are... Why? And here's the thing, too. It's like, why are we celebrating them for finally having common sense?
The PS3 ship with rechargeable controllers.
I know! It's just like, why are we celebrating for a long-delayed feature? Why? We should be like, finally! And like... Oh my goodness.
Just imagine a microphone cell phone that used rechargeable, that did not use rechargeable batteries.
Like, shit,
get rid of AA.
The Xbox One controller doesn't even use Bluetooth yet. I mean, it uses the one for the Slim will have Bluetooth in it, but the Xbox One controller actually did not have Bluetooth in it, which is why you always have to keep freaking plugging in to USB.
Yeah. That's messed up, dude.
Yeah, you got all that teraflopping power, and then you don't bother like spending an extra $5 for your rechargeable battery, because they sell the kit for $20 at Best Buy.
Yeah,
so
it probably cost them a couple bucks.
I know. It's like,
wait, hold on now. Let me ask you guys this, because I don't own one, but the headsets for the Xbox One, like the fancy ones, are they rechargeable or are they battery powered?
They're definitely rechargeable. Well, they're most if they're wireless, then. I don't have a wireless headset.
No, that's what I'm saying. That's a curious question. If they were rechargeable, then what the F, dude? Why are the controllers said to be the ones with the batteries?
Does the Elite controller come with a rechargeable battery? Because when you pay...
I certainly hope so.
When you pay $150 bleeping dollars for that thing, you better have rechargeable batteries in there.
Oh, see, now Nick's curious.
We're
you
looking,
know what? You better
right
look this stuff up now.
I don't
see what's so pro.
Bucks it better.
Man, it took them a long ass time to go, yeah, we'll build in the power brick inside now. You know?
It's like, we don't come with rechargeable batteries, but you can change the color to your liking now. Isn't that sad?
It's customizable, people. You can change the color.
It's customizable. Everything's customizable except the battery. That you have to still have to pay extra for.
Oh my god. But yeah, for such an expensive controller, that they better have freaking rechargeable. It should.
Oh no.
No?
That shit is not use a rechargeable battery.
Oh dude.
It is a $150 controller that uses AA batteries.
No. No.
Yes.
Dude. I am sorry, bro. You did not sell me on that. No. No, now I...
Yes.
Gives me a good reason why not to buy one now.
I'm just like, why do you sell a $150 controller for, like, without batteries?
So,
like,
basically, the controller itself is not $150.
It's
$150
plus... It's $170.
Yeah.
So, it's almost the price of the console.
Oh, my God.
Just for a flipping controller... It gives you like a 0.2% edge in games.
Unless you're able to use your old rechargeable battery stuff, you know, that when you...
Yeah, but that's, that's still not built into the controller. Jeez.
No, but maybe they're assuming that, well, you already own an Xbox One controller.
Yeah,
you probably already bought the rechargeable battery thing.
That
pack.
That new improved Xbox One.
No, it doesn't use the existing charge stand.
Oh, then fuck you guys.
The battery goes indifferently.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just reading that. It does not work with the existing plane charge kit.
Wow. Okay. No. Let me just...
This is how Microsoft's making up...
Yeah, we got a new controller and we're not putting a rechargeable battery.
It's only $150.
But the brick
only.
Is... But the power brick is built in now.
If I am paying $60 for an extra Xbox One controller, why am I still putting AA batteries in it?
No, $150.
No, yeah. I mean like a regular one.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
The lead
controller, that's ridiculous.
For a lead controller, that's... Yeah, I'm just like, oh my goodness, $150. Like...
But the sad part is, they're still going to sell. Because people want
those
controllers.
No, I actually don't know. Actually, I don't know if they lead controller sells or not.
Well, they're still going to sell something. It's not going to be... I mean, we, you know, you can't honestly tell me that no one's gonna buy them.
Well, yeah, it's just, yeah, well, yeah, people could buy it and still sell it crap.
I'm not doing it. I'm not doing that. I know my brother. My brother. I know my brother's crazy enough to do it, but I'm not doing that. I'm not doing that. Are you kidding me?
All right. So that's pretty much the wrap up for Microsoft conference. So what would you guys give it as far as the score goes? An A to F scale.
A what?
An A to F scale.
A to F scale.
Grading scale.
I, you know, honestly, for me, it felt like a C. Felt like a C.
I walked in with an expectation that, you know, it's like, as long as it's not boring, and it's not boring, so that's a C, that it's okay.
Well, boring, it starts with a B.
But if it's B, it would have been entertaining,
God.
Dude.
Yeah, awful starts with A. It doesn't mean it's
with
A.
Atrocious also starts with A.
So you give it a C as well, huh?
F stands for fantastic.
Yeah, when you flip it.
That's what I tell my mom back then when she gets the freaking, you know, your card. I'm like, what are you talking about, mom? That's not an F. That stands for fantastic. There you go. This sign does not stand for failure.
I got it half right. It's fantastic.
So what would you grade it, Anthony?
He said C.
Yeah, I would put it like also a C. Like the only expectation I had for Microsoft was as long as I wasn't bored, which with the exception of Scalebound, I wasn't bored, so that's good.
Well, I mean they had
but
some
at the
good
same
stuff,
time,
yeah.
You know, it wasn't like, you know, there was anything much that was blowing my mind away, which is kinda like another standard conference that was mildly entertaining. So, you know, it's alright, but
yeah, I mean they had some good points, but it still was not. It didn't pack a punch this time. You know?
They tried to pack punches, but you know it's like Sony. Like when you, it's like you watch Sony and you think, wow, these guys know how to get a crowd going. Microsoft, you sort of, kind of, maybe, I don't know how to get a crowd.
Well,
going.
Remember, guys, last year we liked the Microsoft one better, right? Instead of the Sony one.
Last
year or the year before? Was that the year before?
I can't remember.
It was like...
You're talking about the year when we saw Powers? Because that bombed it.
Oh,
really
that
bad.
Was the one.
Oh,
yeah,
that
was the one. That was
awful.
The one.
Season
2's
out,
one.
By the way.
Well, that was the one, yeah.
Yeah,
so it was the one
we didn't talk about.
But anyway, yeah, what about you, Nick?
So I would give it a C+, mainly because, like I said, the whole PC movement's huge. And the fact that it's all like cross-platform and you buy it on one, you get it on both. Super excited about that. Gears of War 4 looked really, really cool. Forza Horizon 3 looked amazing. So, I'd give like a C+.
Alright.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't say they had a bad show, but it wasn't exactly...
No.
It wasn't exactly like stunning either.
Yeah, for me it was like an average show.
Yeah, it just got grand middle of the road most of the time. You know, they didn't do anything wrong, but at the same time they didn't really do much to, you know, just make you go, yeah!
Yeah.
Unlike the beginning of the Sony press conference, since we're segueing into that. So... They didn't do it at the Memorial Coliseum, that's what it's called, right?
Yes.
They don't do it at the Memorial Coliseum because that building actually got torn down. So what they did this time is...
It's not torn down yet, but they're going to
tear it down. Yeah, they're going to tear it down. And so what they did this year is move it to a much smaller venue called... it's called the Shrine.
Like half the size.
Yeah, so it's a shrine. So it's kind of more like a place that they would do plays with or like orchestra performances. So they shrunk it a lot. Free food.
Always free food. That's the best thing about Sony,
food.
Man. You guys rock Sony.
So
and free booze.
They got the drinks. They got the waiter. They got unlimited free food.
The waiter.
And
Nate,
they didn't
the
set up an umbrella at our table, so the sun was in our face the whole time.
But I mean, yeah, that go ahead, keep going. Yeah.
And so we got into a shrine, and I was like, wow, this is kind of like what you would expect if it was like a play stage or a, you know, a symphony stage. And what I started hearing was like a bunch of like violins, like tuning a violin. They would play a single note in order to make sure the whole symphony is in tune. And I was like, oh, is there a symphony behind the curtain? But I didn't realize that there was actually a pit where the symphony members were sitting, and there was actually a choir on the right.
Yeah.
And they started playing that symphony piece, which sounded really awesome.
I know.
Because that was the first time I've ever experienced a symphony playing right before me.
Yeah.
And
they fooled me at first. I thought it was like a Final Fantasy. Like, I thought it was just going to segue to like a Final Fantasy game.
The thing was, to me, I was like, is this Final Fantasy? But then I thought, this sounds sort of like God of War.
Yeah, that's
and
what
I
Nick
turned
told
over,
me too.
And I turned over to you, and I said, this sounds like God of War.
Yeah.
And then when they lifted the curtain and played the video, I was like, oh, actually, you know what? Maybe it might be Horizon instead, because it looks kind
of
like
I was like, this sounds like God of War, and I was like, oh no, this is Horizon. Once they showed the kid, I was like, this is Horizon.
And then the surprise happened.
Kratos looking old as shit.
And we're like, yeah, this is totally God of War.
And everyone lost it.
Well, yeah.
It's also a very different God of War game, too, because it's not like this.
Yeah, it looks completely different.
It looks like a Western RPG.
It looks like an awesome God of War.
It looks like that God of War that we all know, it looks more like a Western RPG type God of War now.
Yeah.
With, you
yeah.
know, his experience points and that kind of stuff. But dude, it was kind of awesome. I'm still like, you know what? It still feels like God of War in a way, even though it's a very different type of game.
Like I said, I was telling you guys, like, man, Sony, for the beginning already, you start off with this. I mean, like, wow.
You start with a freaking symphony.
You know?
That was playing pretty much the whole time.
Yeah, yeah.
It was like, I was like, damn. I mean, like, when Nintendo did that with their 25th anniversary of Legend of Zelda, like, 5 years ago, that was awesome, too. But I was like, damn, that's one of the most epic ways you could ever open
a good way
anything.
To start that freaking conference, man. You know?
I don't even know if I want to call it a conference. I just want to call it giant montage of games to blow your mind away.
Yeah,
it's not a conference. They didn't come out with that whole thing. They didn't bother coming out and saying all the shit that investors need to hear, like with Microsoft. Microsoft is like, you know, we're going to cover everything, including, you know, Xbox Live and networking and all that shit. No, Sony just came out and be like, you know what? Everything, this is giant video game montage session. Prepare to be blown away. And starting off with God of War, blow everyone away. People
yeah.
were standing
Dude,
up, like, just cheering like crazy.
It was
like
amazing.
I said,
it was a good
like,
game.
Sony knows how to work up a crowd.
Sheesh.
In that case, at least.
Your take on this, Nick?
Yeah, so, I mean, it was great. So, Sean Layden, he's the new head of PlayStation who took over after Jack Tretton. And yeah, we saw him a couple times in the Andrew House once. Other than that, no one else even touched the stage.
No.
Because literally just game announcement after game announcement.
They didn't talk, they didn't talk about hardware, except a little bit on the VR. They didn't talk about PlayStation Network. They didn't talk about PlayStation Store. They didn't talk about the Vita at all.
They just said,
surprise. They basically just shoved out a bunch of PS4 stuff that we didn't know about. So it was very surprising, actually.
There's a lot. Yeah, a couple of games that
It's like, you remember
guard.
That time when Xbox was saying, we were going to show you nothing but games for the next hour and a half? This is Sony's version of saying.
But even when they did that, they still had the companies come up on stage and do their talkies.
Yeah,
that's
yes,
stuff.
That. And this is Sony's version. We're literally going to show you nothing but live demos and videos and trailers of games.
They just did it.
Yeah,
it was cool. It was like they used the stage to like the stage changed depending on the game. Which
yeah,
was really cool.
They used it as a built up like a setup for you know for the build up for the suspense of the next game.
Yeah,
you're
it
like,
was really
damn,
cool.
dude. And. Yeah, but I mean, I'm sure a lot of people that have been here, you know, that have been to the Sony press conference, are gonna talk about that just the beginning part of it. I mean, because it was awesome, right? I mean,
yeah,
even
dude,
the
like,
God of War game itself
that game looks so damn good.
Like, there's gonna be a lot of people talking about that game now, just because. I mean,
what has Santa Monica been working on that we never heard about? That.
Yeah, and I remember they kept talking about that.
Is it
Santa Monica?
Is it worth it? Yeah, it's worth it now. it's like, yeah, we were talking kind of shit about it, but now they showed it, you know what?
Well,
why
no, but I remember times, a lot of times, what Nick would tell me, like, you know, Sony Santa Monica's got to be working
on
something.
Yeah, they got to be working on something.
Well, then, now we know, and it's hella, looking hella awesome.
Yeah, holy crap, dude. I mean, that's a God of War game. Before, I wasn't, like, I like God of War, but now it's like, holy crap.
It's like,
I want that God
like
of War
it's
game.
It's a new type of game now, but somehow, it, at least from what I was seeing, it still felt like God of War in a way, because it kind of still felt.
Yeah, dude.
Like, things that
so
Kratos
good.
Does still
for,
feel big. Like
for
it
those
should be.
For those who might have missed it and, like, not watched the press conference, watch it on YouTube or
like
watch it when we have it also. So just
again,
check it
I don't
out.
Even want to call it a press conference. What conference was there? It was just basically them saying, "Hello, gamers, prepare to be blown away," and that's it. Okay, it wasn't even a conference. It was
yeah.
just be blown away.
Just
show.
Yeah, the people who missed it, go watch it. You gotta get your mind blown.
And I can't really think of any other way you could just open up anything, any show. Better than what they did. I mean, I don't think like maybe like some people don't like to just like because the whole curtain was down the entire time that Sony
yeah.
was playing.
But it was
so
the
actually,
it was the build up though.
It was the build up, and it went on for a little while. So you weren't like you didn't really know. All you could guess was the music sounded like maybe this game or that game. But
yeah.
they basically played the entire. That's probably the whole main theme of God of War now.
Well, no, that's what the guy said. That was the
yeah,
song.
Yeah, that's the main theme, and you know it's like a full on symphonic movement in a way, and it's like. You don't know what it is, and the curtain is still down.
Yeah.
And so it's like, and then it finally like raised it up, and it's like, oh.
Yeah, then that was a very
that
good
That has
beginning.
To be one of the coolest ways to reveal
a
game.
That
I'll
was
just,
a
I'll just put that right
very
now.
Good beginning.
Because you got awesome music, you've got the reveal of a character that people know, and you have kind of like rebooted a game, but well, you didn't reboot the game, but you like, it's God of War continued, but in a very different
yeah.
direction. But
I'm
it's
sure
a very different gameplay now, but somehow still looks
we'll,
like.
We'll get more info on that eventually. But I mean, as of for now, what they showed us was just already.
Oh, it looks so damn good.
Like, you know how epic is one of the most overused words to describe big, grand games? Well, I'm saying, the God of War is kind of like, it symbolizes epic. Right, fucking Kratos
yeah.
destroyed the Greek world in God of War 3, and you know what? Like this new God of War also feels huge
and it's just,
and
they just
and
went
I
back
freaking
to
love it.
They just went back to this. It's just God of War now, right? It's not God of War or something something.
Yeah,
it's
called
God of
War.
It's the new chap. It's the new style of God of War now. Cause
yeah,
it's like,
and,
it's like
and I like what they did with it.
It's like third person over their shoulder kind of thing now, and like that's certainly very different than that.
Yeah. Because, you know, when people that played the old God of War games, they're used to what they've been always been playing.
But here's
the
thing. This is, like, another case of it still feels like God of War, but maybe it's, like, it's new, it's different, but at the same time, it still feels, it still keeps that feeling that you loved from the originals.
Oh, yeah. Let's
God of War 3 is crazy. He blew up the Greek world. But
so there was more than God of War announced. That is how they started it, though.
I know.
Then they went into The Last Guardian and announced that it's coming out on PlayStation 4 on October 25th.
Yeah, they
actually
have a date now.
I noticed the boy looks different this time.
Yeah.
He looks more cel-shaded.
Yeah, they actually had a date when the release date now
and
is.
This
so.
Year. I was expecting a date, just not this year.
Yeah. But that's good news for a lot of fans.
It has to come out
now. Yeah, now it's like, yeah.
It
well,
has
it's
to come
on
out
now, people.
It's like Final Fantasy 15. It has to come out, or otherwise everyone's like going to be like, what the heck?
Yeah, you can't. Well, they can't. It comes to a point where like you can't just keep people waiting now. It's like
yeah, eventually they're just gonna give up. Like,
yeah,
I'm pretty sure people almost completely gave up on Final Fantasy 13 versus said, you know what, they say they're working on it, but we haven't seen anything in years.
Yeah.
So we're just forget it. It doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah. It looks good though. I mean, they didn't really show much extra gameplay
other than your companion takes a fall and
yeah, I think I saw. Didn't they show like two of them too?
The shadow version.
Oh, shadow version. Okay.
Because it's like a theme in some Japanese games where there's like a shadow version of yourself or something like Dark Link.
All right. Well, that's a big announcement though. People that have been waiting for that game. Now you know when it's coming out. What was the next one after that one?
So then Sony announced a new post-apocalyptic game called Days Gone.
All right.
Which
looks interesting, because at the end they showed gameplay, so they announced it, and I thought that was really weird.
To me,
how you announce the game and then end it, be like, oh yeah, here's a game that we already talked about, but here's gameplay.
But, like, I look at the gameplay, I'm like, oh, more zombies. Oh, more killing
it
zombies.
It seems to be, like you
it's
said,
like, it's
like, a big
it's like, what, it's like another zombie game?
You know
what,
honestly, for me, though, when I first saw it, I thought it was going to be Infamous, like another Infamous, maybe.
Yeah.
I was hoping, but it didn't turn out that way.
Yeah, I would love to see a new Infamous announced.
But it is another zombie game. It's just so nice.
The gameplay makes me think,
Well, this zombie game actually has me interested.
Really?
Dead Rising I'm not into. Because it's, like, way over the top and ridiculous. This game, it's, like, this game's, like, a realistic zombie
game. I don't know. I could see it work. I don't know.
It reminds me of 28
You have to be very, you have to, like, you have to notice your environment is what I noticed about that game. Because you have to notice where's that creaky platform. You have to notice where that explosive tank is. So that way you can slow them down. Like, you actually have to pay attention to your environment.
I like the little touches.
Slow down from chasing.
I don't know. I like the little touches where, like, when you close that gate, you know? Because, like, in some games, you just run and you just keep running.
Well, I would keep running too instead of just poking at the gate thinking, oh, my problem's completely solved.
Well, no, but I'm just saying, like, you know, like when he even crossed that one thing and he just closed it so that, you know, it would enough to at least slow him down just for a little bit.
Yeah.
It looks interesting. Kind of like the zombies there kind of remind me like the 28 Days Later kind of zombies.
Mm.
Where they are running, you know, they actually run at you and stuff. So it looks interesting. You know, the main character is freaking from that TV show. That biker TV show. What was that one?
I don't know.
Oh, I can't remember.
Oh,
that one biker show.
Shit.
Yeah, see, I can't remember.
Were they modifying?
No. It's a TV series.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, I know.
Shit, it's gonna drive me nuts.
It's gonna drive me nuts now, so you have to look it up.
What is that called?
See, I don't remember.
Sons of Anarchy.
There you go.
Yeah
your main character is somebody from Sons. No, he's not really his, but he reminds me of a guy from Sons of Anarchy.
Yeah.
You know, it's a different take on a main character.
Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah, it looks interesting. We'll see more of it.
Yeah, so then they showed 8 minutes of gameplay of Horizon Zero Dawn, which I'm still super stoked for.
It looks a lot like the gameplay they first showed last year.
Yeah, but you noticed that there's newer stuff.
Yeah, they showed, like, mining.
They showed a slightly cheesier version of the BioWare conversation wheel.
Well, that, and they also showed, like, you know, like the hacking part of it where she controlled that one creature.
Yeah, that was really cool.
Yeah, riding on it, like mounting it and stuff. Too bad she didn't mount it.
Annoyed by the conversation wheel because the dialogue just didn't seem very good and their facial animations are like, eh. And I'm like, this looks almost like a copy from Mass Effect.
Well.
Or Dragon Age.
But as far as the way the game looked, it looks good. It still looks good. It still looks
good. I like when the guy runs away and he's like, you're crazy. And I'm like, yep.
Well, the new weapons that they show, the new things you can do, I enjoyed that.
You actually have to analyze the thing and find its weak point. And it's not just the weak point, but you have to fire the correct type of arrow at that weak point. So maybe it needs to be fired.
I'm actually digging that thing where she anchors, like she shoots you with it, then she anchors you to the ground, anchors the enemies.
And you fall over. And
then
he falls over.
I like that. That's a pretty cool idea. I mean, it's
pretty awesome. Yeah.
It looks good. Like, I mean, what else can be said about this game? We've seen the gameplay. We've seen some more gameplay with some more new weapons and other things you can do, and it looks pretty good already.
Yeah.
Cool.
What's the next on the list?
So then they went on to announce Resident Evil 7, and it will be a PlayStation VR game.
Yeah, which fooled the
and
crap
it's
out of
January 24th.
It fooled the crap out of me and Nick.
It fooled the crap out of everybody.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Oh, it's more horror. Oh, it's another zombie virus.
No,
I saw it, and I was like, oh, it's going to be called V.
No, because
no, it was actually part of the title Resident Evil, which everyone was like, oh.
No, my thing was, when I first saw it, I was like, what? Is this, like, a new version of Silent Hill? That's what my thought was.
out.
You know, yeah, and then I guess Nick's thought was something
else. My thought
else.
Was, this is some poor game that makes no sense.
Outlast.
Outlast.
That's the game I thought it was. I thought it was going to be like a sequel to Outlast.
Yeah.
Oh, man, Outlast with VR, you're dead. you're gonna.
I was watching that show, I'm like, screw that.
I know, he was telling me the whole time,
I
he was
not,
next to me.
I am not playing
Bronson,
that crap in
Bronson
VR.
Bronson was scared like a little girl from what he told me when he played Outlast, and I'm just like, yeah.
Now you have this thing off where you can't even freaking, you're going to see everything. And
yeah,
you have to rip the thing off your damn head.
Yeah, and your heart would stop. You will die just from playing that game from sheer terror.
But I mean, for a lot of horror fans, well, there you go. Now you actually get to live it.
Screw that. You gotta be freaking mentally disturbed. I can't wait to play that in VR.
Yeah, they can do that.
You're disturbed.
Yeah, they can do that. I'm just going to play happier games that don't kill me.
Okay. Yeah, that, I mean, but for what it's worth,
I don't want to play the VR game where I die. It's just playing a VR game where she's jumping at me.
I know, but I get so scared that my heart starts with your terror.
It's one thing to watch a horror movie or play a horror game.
Yeah.
It's another thing to actually be able to freaking see it in, like you're in there.
I've been on the Hollywood Hotel at California Adventure Park, which basically puts you in what feels like a falling elevator, because it is.
Oh, I can do that.
Yeah, that was pretty scary, actually, in a fun way, whereas Outlast is scary in a, I'm going to die if I keep playing this game, because my heart will stop from the sheer terror.
You know they're going to do an Outlast 2.
They're
going
to do Outlast 2, and then, you know, someone's going to do something on YouTube where they glue or tape the headset on, so you can't take it off, so you're stuck having to deal with the whole 6 hours of Outlast.
Can you guys imagine, like you know, there's going to be bad things that happen with this game, if, you know, for other people that play it.
Yeah.
You know, there's going to be a lot of bad things.
Yeah, you can have a seizure and end up in, like,
people with getting heart attacks, people, like, freaking losing their crap, you know?
You could actually have a class action lawsuit for that.
So, it's...
Someone's going to be playing the game and, like, throw some shit and, like, kill someone.
Yeah, or they play the game and they end up in the hospital for, like, you know, heart murmurs or whatever,
imagine like having your grandma play this game.
No, don't even say that, because you know what? I'm pretty sure someone in YouTube is gonna do that.
So in addition to the photo epilepsy warning that comes with every game, they now have to include a heart health warning saying if you have cardiac problems, do not play this game.
With the PlayStation VR, it's gonna come with a heart rate monitor, and once your heart hits a certain speed, it'll automatically cut it off.
Well, you know,
or it'll show like unicorns jumping in a.
You know, that would be a good safety feature, right?
Yeah.
But the reason why I say this is because, like, I've seen YouTube videos where, like, their kids have their parents, like, do the VR, but at the roller coaster ride. So I'm like, oh, dear God, if kids try to do that to their parents and it's like that game, oh my God.
Something jumps out on them.
It's like, yeah, in addition to epilepsy warnings, they now have a warning saying if you have high blood pressure or cardiac issues, do not play horror VR games.
The safety feature.
Yeah, they have to put it very clear because some people don't have very good hearts, and I don't want them dead over a game.
No, what I'm saying is, like, the safety feature of the VR that they're gonna add just for safety, though, like, it's a defibrillator.
Yeah, which goes with the heart rate monitor. You just give it to text when your heart rate is seizing up. If your heart is seizing up, it will defibrillate you.
But the other stuff that they showed besides that one, you know, because like I said, there's not much I can say about that game, because I will play it. Are you kidding me? I won't play that game. If you love that kind of games, good for you.
By all means, nothing scares you.
Yeah, play it to your heart's content. That is nothing.
Although I'm going to avoid you more because you somehow managed to not be scared of that. But yeah, okay. So Resident Evil Biohazard.
Resident
I thought
Evil.
It was going to be called V, and then it said Resident Evil, and everyone was losing their minds about
it. Well, yeah, it fooled the crap out of me. I thought it was going to be...
Yeah, it got everyone.
Yeah. What was the one after that one?
It was a bunch more VR titles.
Yeah, but that was the thing, though. Like, they didn't
Star
stop
Wars,
there, right?
Star
they didn't
Wars,
stop there.
Star Wars Battlefront VR X-Wing Experience.
That was the next one?
I think so, because they were talking about here's some stuff that's coming VR. They started showing serious games for VR. So at PlayStation Experience.
Well, what they showed after, so they ended up announcing that the PlayStation VR is coming out October 13th.
Which is good for
yeah.
people.
And priced at $399, so it's pretty much priced at the same price as the console.
Yeah,
but
which is a
VR
dire.
Technology is still new, so it's kind
yeah.
of one of those. This tech
it's is cheaper than Oculus Rift at $600.
Oh, that's true.
It's cheaper than the HTC Vive also.
Yeah.
So, like
the
VR,
price is reasonable.
Like VR just came out and it's new tech, so
yeah.
it's still. Expensive.
I wouldn't say it's overpriced. It's reasonable. It's a reasonable price.
Oh, the Resident Evil 7, obviously the VR isn't out, but the demo for Resident Evil 7 is on the PlayStation Store now.
Yeah,
for
I know.
PlayStation Plus members.
But how would you use it? I mean, if it's VR...
Well, it's not
it's
VR.
It's a regular game.
Okay.
It's not a VR. It just has capabilities for VR display.
Yeah, they said that by the end of the year, there's going to be 50 PlayStation VR games.
That's actually quite a lot. That's better than most
launch. Well, at least, yeah, games. Right? Because, I mean, like, the last, was it the Move? That was like, oh, you know, games, and you know, it was crappy games.
Oh, well, the Move sold super well, though. They sold like 25. They sold like 25 million units.
Not as well as the Kinect, and not as
well.
Well, as,
of course.
Yeah,
well, part of that's because the Kinect came with a lot of consoles, and they had hit games like Dance Central.
But at least this
one was not a hit game.
No, when they released the Kinect as a standalone option, it actually broke the record set by the iPhone 4, I think, for most computer hardware sold in a 1 or 2 week period.
Well, at least with this one, it gives me a little more hope now with that VR stuff, because you know. When we went to the PlayStation Experience, we're like, really? This is what you guys are showing us? You know, the, some of the games they had there.
Yeah.
And then now they show this like, all this other stuff, and you're like, wow, this actually
yeah,
like that
work.
Battlefront X-Wing VR thing, and what else?
The Star Wars Battlefront one. There was the, what was the other ones they had on there? I forgot. I don't know. Off the
My computer's not cooperating with me. what else? Yeah, so they announced the Star Wars game.
There was that. The other one was the Call of Duty one, which fooled the crap out of me, too. I thought it was totally something different game, too. The Call of Duty game.
What's Call of Duty announced for VR?
Yeah, remember it was that VR one where you thought it was Titanfall 2.
Yeah, about... Was that... I don't think they announced
it. It was
that.
VR.
Well, the hard part is that they kept showing video after video, so I don't know where the VR ended. Because it's like, is it confirmed for VR? Oh, Final Fantasy 15 VR.
15 VR, which is... I thought that was
it's
good.
A little silly.
Batman.
Batman VR, that one's going to be fun.
Yeah, Batman.
For me, that's going to be fun. I'll enjoy
yeah.
doing that. You know, there's a... Like, there's a hope that actually now watch... After seeing all the other stuff, there's hope for the VR. That,
well,
you know.
As a serious gaming device, they finally showed some stuff, actually.
Yeah, yeah. Instead of the
instead
cheesy
of, like,
stuff.
Instead of, like, Super Robot Golf.
Yeah, you know... This one, like now, after seeing what their lineup for the VR now, makes me go, okay, good, there's hope. You know, except I'm not playing the horror games, but there's hope for the shooters. Because that's the first thing that comes to my mind, right? When you say, we're going to make a game that goes with VR. Well, what better one to do it than with first-person shooters, right? Would be the best time to do it. And
they did show a shooter, I think.
They showed this other, like... survival one, right? It was a space one where he was in space and he was shooting stuff, and it was in the
yeah.
it was a survival type game. I just don't remember the dang title anymore, but it looked good. It looked good. I'm willing to bet you that Call of Duty one that we watched that was VR.
I don't think so. It because the VR just kind of stopped at some point. It's like it didn't say anything about it being VR that I knew about. I'm actually just going back into the video since the next internet's not working. Horizon Zero?
Yeah, there's no reference to Call of Duty.
Oh, we forgot Detroit Become Human.
Well, I'm getting there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got that pulled up next. I was just getting through the VR stuff. But yeah, so the next game from Quantic Dream, Detroit Become Human, was announced.
This one is.
And it looks exactly like another Quantic Dream game.
Yeah,
yeah.
But it interests me, though. It really does interest me now.
It's
this
like,
one.
You can have, a, well, they're doing, how do I say this? He's doing that thing that a lot of games tried to do in the past, which is try and branch out the story where 17 different choices will lead to 35 different endings, kind of thing.
Yeah, but I'm still fine with that. I like that.
But what I'm saying is that a lot of games have done that and either branched back into the same three endings or...
Yeah, but The Witcher...
Well, yes, there is The Witcher, but I'm saying a lot of games. I don't mean every game. Okay, it's like sometimes I would play Dragon Age 2, and it's like you made a lot of decisions, but really you're kind of restricted down to like two or three endings.
Yeah, but from what they showed in this one, it looks good to me. I mean, to me, it looks good. It interests me. I like that. The way it looks, the way it was introduced to me when I'm like the trailer. I believe it is the whole gameplay. Looks good. Like, I like what I'm seeing.
Choice.
Yeah, well.
A lot of choice.
I like what I'm seeing. I will be one to check this game out. Oh, there was that freaking Resident Evil.
Yeah. People were losing their minds.
Cool, so after that,
there was something made by Impulse Gear, which is that Mars, unknown planet.
Survival thing.
And a survival thingy going on, and Farpoint, I think it's called Farpoint.
It's Farpoint.
Then they showed the X-Wing thing, and then they showed the Batman thing, where the cow. And then they showed the Chocobo thingy from Final Fantasy.
Yeah, you can play as the Final Fantasy character, I forgot his name, Blunto or something, whatever his name is.
Prompto.
And it's in VR.
And then it showed the Call of Duty thing, which I had no idea.
This is VR right here. This is part of the VR showcase.
It didn't say if it ran VR. It just said Call of Duty, here's the editions.
Yeah, because all the VR games at the end, they always close it off with VR.
And then they showed Call of Duty 4, which they also didn't say if it was on VR or not.
Wait, what does it say there?
Campaign 30 days early, only on PS4.
Huh, well, doesn't say VR. Oh, well. I thought
I
it was, though, right? I mean,
they just showed video after video. They didn't actually said when the VR stopped. What's also interesting, I just noticed, is that as I filmed this, there was a guy texting on his phone the entire time. And the screen was caught by the camera.
Crash Bandicoot.
Yeah, so that's what I was getting into. So Sony announced that they're going to be remastering Crash Bandicoot, and it'll be coming to Skylanders... If you play Skylanders.
Do you notice how excited his voice sounded?
The remaster can be pretty cool.
Yeah, for Crash Bandicoot fans, yeah, there you go.
Yeah, so they showed Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, which actually looked really exciting. My only thing is that's probably the best part of the game.
Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, that announcement trailer, is the second most hated video on YouTube that hasn't been taken down yet.
That's
the most
pretty
hated
awful.
The most hated being a Justin Bieber song.
Yeah, but you know, what was pretty awful about that too was, Nick and I were trying to guess what it was the whole time, and he thought it was the fall.
At first, I was like, "Oh, it looks like Killzone," and then I was like, "Oh no, this is definitely Titanfall 2."
Yeah, and then we were like, "What the hell?" It was freaking Call of Duty. It just, you know.
Maybe it's because it wasn't as set piece ridiculous as it used to be.
Yeah.
I think they toned down the stupid set piece. Because Modern Warfare 3 was a kind of like a really bad offender of that stuff, because every time you climbed up a ladder, you always saw a fighter jet fly overhead for some reason. Cue fighter jet, because man,
yeah, but the thing is,
ladder.
Though, is what, to Nick's point then, is like, you know, well, they could have just showed us the freaking best parts of the game.
Yeah.
Well, considering how many people hate it, they needed to get the best part of the game to convince everybody they should hate it.
Yeah.
Yes, that was another game during Microsoft conference. They showed Battlefield 1, which looks pretty cool.
Yeah, Battlefield 1 looks pretty cool. I mean,
World War 1 is pretty awesome. Is a pretty interesting point in time, really. So I think it's a great place to visit. As far as like kid making games go, I'm not saying I'm gonna go back in time and visit the days of mustard gas and first gen tanks. No.
And biplanes and all that.
And
stuff.
And biplanes and trench warfare and drowning when it rains too much. Yeah, no thank you.
What was the next one after?
After
that
Call
one?
Of Duty,
so,
Andrea House came out,
right?
And said said some things, but the thing what he said is, oh yeah, we have a legendary game developer, roll up curtain and crowd goes berserk.
Ta-da!
It's Hideo Kojima.
Which, yeah.
Announced his new game Death Stranding starring Norman Reedus.
Yep. Norman
the guy from The Walking Dead.
Yes, Norman Reedus Phyllis. Filming?
What?
and actually plays Kojima music.
Yeah. And, I mean, from what I'm seeing here in the cinematic and the way it looks good so far. I mean, I didn't
Featuring
see...
Norman Reedus, which... Where is that guy cast before?
The Walking Dead.
Walking Dead.
Right.
He's the most favorite character in The Walking Dead. But then that one was like, I want to see more of this game.
Well, yeah, of course you do. It's made by Hideo Kojima. How could you not?
Yeah, exactly. I want to see more. Like, what is it? Like, what exactly are we looking at?
I'm actually currently a tad more curious about how Hideo Kojima feels about Metal Gear Pachinko machines.
Okay.
Because Konami's making Metal Gear Pachinko machines now.
But it's good to know that people love this guy.
Like,
as soon as he came out of that stage, you know, walked up, and everyone was going nuts, you know.
All they have to do is just roll up the car and everyone went berserk.
Yeah.
That's all they have to do.
Yeah. It's Hideo Kojima. what else do we have?
Yeah, so they...
Spider-Man!
And I just looked it up to see, it is exclusive. So I just read on the PlayStation blog, it is exclusive.
What?
Yes. Because Sony never said during the conference it was exclusive to Sony.
They just said hashtag Spider-Man PS4.
Yeah, but I'm reading on the PlayStation blog from Insomniac today at PlayStation press conference to reveal our new Spider-Man game coming in exclusively to PlayStation 4. That's crazy. It's like Insomniac, they were doing Ratchet and Clank and Resistance exclusively for PlayStation, and then they did, what's that game they did for Xbox One?
I don't know.
Sunset Overdrive?
Sunset Overdrive, which I love that game. And now they're back to Sony. Yeah, they did Ratchet and Clank, but with Spider-Man. So I think it'd be really cool. The rumor was that Sucker Punch was going to be doing Spider-Man. And it would make sense because they do Infamous, which is a similar style game.
Yeah, but instead we, you know.
But Insomniac did Sunset Overdrive, and that's kind of, it's similar mechanics. So this is interesting, because like I'm not really into superheroes or superhero games, but I love the Batman games. So I'm definitely going to be into trying this Spider-Man game out.
Yeah,
especially with a team like Insomniac behind it.
Yeah, I would enjoy playing a Spider-Man game. I mean, I remember playing the older ones, and I enjoyed those. Because, you know, the one was free roaming, you know, the whole Spider-Man
game.
Yeah, it was great. I'm curious to see what is different about this Spider-Man game. You know what I mean? Because, like, the ones back then, you're like, yeah, I swing through the city. Yeah, I can get on to the
Well, I imagine it's going to do what every Spider-Man story always starts with, which is, yeah, it's gonna be like every single time a Spider-Man comic line starts, whether it's Ultimate Spider-Man or the Amazing Spider-Man or the Spectacular Spider-Man, always starts with Peter Parker getting bit. So I can imagine this is another Peter Parker origins story going on.
Or this could be that, you know, this game could be introducing us to the way, because, you know, if you guys watched the Civil War, you know, the way this new Spider-Man is going to be from here on. You know, like the movie, the single movie Spider-Man. Give us an idea of what it might, you know, the way it's going to go. I don't know. But I am curious to see what makes this Spider-Man different, what this Spider-Man game different from the ones I played way back then, you know?
Yeah.
If it's just swinging, like, oh yeah, I swing through city. We've seen that. We've seen people.
For a moment, I got confused because I thought Insomniac made Infamous, but no, that's Sucker Punch.
Yeah, that's Sucker Punch.
Yeah, Insomniac were the ones that made Ratchet and Clank?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, we forgot. So the Call of Duty, they announced that Call of Duty Modern Warfare is getting remastered.
Yeah.
And it's coming to PlayStation 30 days or before.
Why would they have to fight for such a meat?
But the good news is...
Oh, yeah, they announced LEGO Star Wars The Force Awakens.
Yeah.
The demo's on the PlayStation Store. It's out in 2 weeks.
I felt like the crowd was not really digging the jokes as well as the developers hoped they would.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I wasn't exactly laughing at the jokes. And it's not really because I didn't see the movies. Because, you know, I think their humor was kind of like...
It's for kids. Come on, guys.
Yeah.
Don't bring it down. It's for kids. What was the next one after the Lego Star Wars?
So that's, I think that...
After Spider-Man was that demo of the zombie game.
Yeah.
And then that's it.
Days Gone.
Which actually seems a little shorter, not that we've gone through it like that, but...
Yeah, but, I mean, just...
Well, to be fair, Sony's conference was, like, barely over an hour. versus Microsoft was like an hour and 40 minutes.
Yeah.
But that's because Microsoft had a lot of talking in between.
Yeah. But the
we
Sony
are proud
one was
to have some of the most innovative studios in the entire world, and I cannot be more excited to be at E3 now. I want to talk to you about a brand new game that's innovative that allows choice to change your world. There, see, I just made some cliched good feel good lines right there.
Yeah, but I mean, Sony's press.
Why do I feel like the next E3 I should write a tally of like overused phrases like we strive to make the have the best studios. Innovation,
exclusive,
best online service. Like, I just want to have a tally of the most overused buzzwords in the press conferences. Sony actually didn't talk much on this one. That's probably why I liked it so much. That has to be the best Sony one I've seen so far, because very little talk, lots of awesome stuff, lots of epic.
Yeah.
It's like, oh,
great,
man.
Great opening.
It's
wow.
Like, I just walked out of that thinking, oh, my God, I am happy to be, like, owning a PlayStation 4 right now. That's
yeah.
Probably what you want people to think
in
when
fact,
they leave.
That, in fact, remember I told you guys, too, like, well, I'm actually, I have high hopes for this
yeah.
VR
I
thing
didn't
now.
Leave the Xbox conference. I didn't leave the Xbox conference thinking, oh, I'm happy to own an Xbox. I just left the Xbox conference thinking, oh, man, I get to enjoy my PC more.
Yeah, that's how I left, too.
Yeah, I left just like, oh, cool, I get my
yeah.
Forza on PC. I didn't think about the Xbox Scorpio,
yeah.
The slim version. I just walked out thinking nothing about the console, more about how my PC's good experience
yeah.
is slightly better because I can buy Forza for it now.
Whereas with Sony,
I walked out and just think, oh, God, I was like, wow, that's fucking awesome.
Yep.
And
wow, this VR thing is
no,
actually going
like,
to be working
no
out.
No BS.
Looks like.
They don't need to talk about PlayStation Network. I felt like they didn't talk about PlayStation Network because they didn't have their usual stage. Because all they had was a roll down screen and, you know.
I think
background.
they might have listened to what people were saying, like, you know, with the.
No, they didn't even do that thing that they did at all the other press conferences, or just have the executives come out and be like, I'm one of you guys! I'm a gamer too! I play Destiny! Rise of Iron's coming out, which I'm surprised they didn't announce Rise of Iron. Come to think of it. Because you know how Destiny's always talked about at PlayStation?
Yeah.
They didn't talk about Rise of Iron. Yeah, even though Rise of Iron can now be pre-ordered on the PlayStation Store.
Yeah, I'm surprised they didn't talk about Destiny, that's for sure, because Sony invested a lot of money into it.
Yeah, and one of their executives plays Destiny a lot.
Huh. Oh, well.
Yeah. But hey, I guess they stuck to the stuff that gets people going, and damn, they blew people's minds away.
They have blown people's
minds.
Yeah,
the only two things I think that if they announced these two, it would have been like the perfect press conference is a new Infamous and The Last of Us 2.
Yeah. Yeah.
If they announced those two, I don't even know what else you could have asked for.
A bigger auditorium.
with
seats that allow for taller people to fit comfortably in. That's probably the bit most you can ask for. The venue.
Dude, I was so miserable sitting there.
But at least the conference was awesome, so we reduced the misery a bit.
Yeah, and they still fed us. And gave us drinks.
Yeah.
So I guess you guys
so
are yeah,
grading.
Yeah, there you go. Grading. So who wants to go first? I guess me then. Fuck you guys.
But I give it. It's still really fresh in my head right now, but the gut feeling is like I don't give it an A. I can't really think how you can do much better. I mean, it's like yeah, obviously some games I don't care about. But the thing is, obviously they're not going to cater an entire conference to one specific group of gamer. You have to cater to like your entire PlayStation crowd, which likes a variety of games. So like, I sit down and I'm like, that has to be one of the best ways I've ever seen people open up a conference, because it just built up this awesome thing, and it happens to be the new God of War.
Yeah.
You can't build up any better than that. The ending, yeah. Closing off with that zombie demo was
that was
kind of
really
like,
weird.
Yeah.
They might
awkward.
Have just kind of added that in the, like, you know, like, extra somehow.
Yeah. It was kind of awkward. And also, the montage videos clearly showed some stuff that didn't say elsewhere. Like,
there's probably just see it at E3 now.
It's like, you know, I saw Gran Turismo in that montage and Persona, and I'm just like, huh. They didn't talk about that stuff at all, but I guess that's part of the PlayStation family, so.
So you give it an A?
I don't know, I'm kind of like on the border between an A or A minus, because obviously it's like the ending was somehow I felt like, they did a great job getting everyone so excited, and then they demoed
a zombie game that felt like, oh wow, here's another zombie game, and that just kind of didn't exactly give, you know, give them like hurrah.
I feel like that last part of it was more of like an unplanned thing. I feel like that's what it was. It's just
like,
kind of
like,
well,
like, oh,
let's just show
crap,
it anyway.
We don't know what to end with. Eh, let's just show them the zombie game that
yeah.
we announced at the beginning.
I'll give it, you know what? I'll give it an A- as well because of the end part. But the beginning, oh my gosh. But the end part just felt kind of like, eh.
They
all
used
right.
to try the best they could, and goddamn, it was awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll give an A- too. I mean, like I said, they did really damn good. Is that they could have announced a couple more games for the perfect score,
they just stuck to why you are crazy about PlayStation. It's not because of PlayStation Network. It was because you wanted another God of War and you're ready to be blown away.
Yeah.
I'm like,
you
oh
want,
my goodness. It was just an endless montage of awesome stuff. I'm like, wow.
yeah.
That has to be the best Sony press conference I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I mean, the PlayStation Network stuff, you could just talk about later in interviews and all that stuff, but what people want to, like, when a crowd watches it, they want to get excited about what they bought or thinking about buying, okay? It's just like, oh, PlayStation Network lets you do this stuff and powers, and I don't know about you, but I don't think people buy a PlayStation 4 for powers. Never, I don't know.
About mine for it.
But they took advantage of the whole, like, the theater. They took advantage of that. Like, we're in the theater, let's make it, like, a grand opening.
Dude, the fact that they have, like, the orchestra, like, it during plays, you can have a live orchestra, and that's where that lower level right there is for. And, dude, they're, like, they were actually playing live music. Because all you have to do is just peek over, you can see
yeah.
the conductor still conducting. Even during the demo of the zombie game, he was also conducting an orchestra to play stuff. And every time a Sony executive walked on, they would play something. And I'm just like, wow, how nice is it to just like waltz onto the stage with an orchestra playing your arrival?
Yeah. So, yeah, A-. It's all of us. It's unanimous. You know? That was just a great presentation.
Yeah, not much you can do better. That's like, man, that's like...
And now I'm like, really, like, I want to see more of this
God
of War game.
I just want to go home, lay down, and be like, so, I'm glad PS4 remains on my desk. Xbox One, you're retired already because my PC has taken over your duties.
Yeah, I want to see more of this God of War game. I want to see more of the Kojima game.
I don't think the God of War game is going to come until 2017.
No, I mean, like, you know, more a display of more stuff that, you know, could possibly be in that game that...
The Kojima game doesn't tell me much at all, actually. It was just kind of more like a, hey, Kojima actually has a proof of concept, and you all shall get excited. And I actually
still worked with Norman Reedus. Like, everybody thought that was done. Everybody thought, because it was supposed to be for Silent Hill, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then everybody thought that just fell through, and that was done. And then here you go, he shows it anyway, and you're like, whoa, this is not what I thought it was.
Yeah. In the case of the Kojima game, I noticed that the cheering kind of tapered off because everyone's cheering for Hideo Kojima. But when they sell the game, I still don't know what the game is about at all. Other than a couple shots and we're staring at the sky as these five floating things are coming a little closer slowly. And I'm just like, I have no idea what this game is about. I just know what it's called. I just know that it features Norman
Reedus. Like I said, knowing Kojima, he's... Like when it comes to the stories, it's gonna be some weird stuff, you know. But creative.
Glad to see his music taste is exactly the same.
Yeah.
Because he still wants to make a music video. He even stuck the name of the song in the trailer, and I'm like,
yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that's a total
it's
Kojima
be,
touch right there.
It's gonna be some like it's gonna be an I you know we'll see how the game turns out and you know like the characters and all that. But like for me, like you know playing the Metal Gear games and. The characters that he creates, because like the Metal Gear villains that he made with those female villains, I forgot what they're called now.
Beauty and Beast Corps.
Yeah, you heard the stories of each of those girls, and you're like,
yeah,
damn it, that's
yeah,
all messed
yeah,
up stories.
Up,
you know,
yeah.
So you know this one looks like it's pretty messed up too, because you know he's Roman Reed just stands up and there's a baby, just disappears or melts or something.
She was getting crazy.
Yeah.
Oh, but people
Jeez.
Love it, don't they?
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. It's the creativity, and it's just, you know, we'll see.
He loves his food too, by the way.
Yeah. Yes, we heard about that one.
Yep.
Yeah, but overall, Sony wins this one. Sony wins this one.
Well, yeah. It's like Microsoft's just kind of been flat lately. It's like, it, to them, it's like a lot of hardware talk, a lot of, we got innovative studios with some of the most creative talent in the world, and I'm just like, I heard this speech a bajillion times. God darn it. And Sony, it's like, we're one of you guys. Hey, more Destiny. We love indies. And I'm just like, ugh.
Yeah, but not this time.
Yeah, not, that's why I like Sony so much this time. It's like, this time they don't bother talking that much.
I just love how
they
just
They just
media.
Got to the point and just threw everything out.
It's finally dead, guys.
Huh?
It's finally dead.
Don't
what
tell
is,
Bronson that.
What is
the Vita.
Oh, yeah.
You know it's dead.
They don't
even
mention
it.
One word about the Vita, the entire thing. They just said PlayStation 4. That's it.
Yeah, they didn't mention the other rumor about the PlayStation something something.
No, Andrew Howe specifically said, oh, yeah, the PlayStation 4 Neo exists, we're just not going to talk about it. And, that's, and they stuck to that. Instead, they showed us games to show us why PlayStation 4 is awesome, instead of, like, what Microsoft's doing, which is why hardware should be awesome. Well, yeah, hardware's great.
Well, yeah.
So he's like, you bought a PS4. Now we're going to continue showing why owning a PS4 continues to be awesome instead
yeah.
of Microsoft, which is, yeah, you bought an Xbox One.
Oh
anyways.
My god, my buddy at work is going to be going crazy too because he's going to see God of War and it's on PlayStation 4. And he owns an Xbox One, so, you know, yikes.
Ow.
Ouch. But there you go, folks. You heard it. Sony took this one. They just dominated.
Yeah. So we're gonna move this forward. So we actually got two comments, and Nick's finally here to contribute his.
Yeah, just throwing a quick thing out there. So EA and Ubisoft did have conferences.
Oh right.
We were swamped with Sony and Microsoft, so we need to catch up on that. But we will be touring Ubisoft. I think it's tomorrow, so we'll let you guys know. We'll be doing one of these every day, so we'll let you guys know what our thoughts are on what we check out with Ubisoft. EA is not at E3, but I'm sure we'll talk about it tomorrow.
It kind of depends. They're kind of at E3, but
they're not on the
off-site. They're off-site.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, okay. So we got comments.
This was a long one.
Yeah, I guess. The first one is from Eddie. Some great predictions here. I could see Sony being more hardware than anything else considering all the mentions of hardware lately. Yeah, that completely got flipped.
They flipped the script.
We thought they were going to talk about PlayStation Neo and PlayStation VR and what happened. They just showed a bajillion
games. They just blew our minds.
The only hardware they talked about was when the VR was coming out and the price it's going to be.
And then it made me change my mind about the VR after what I saw. So, yeah.
Agreed that Sony's hardware experience, think you nailed that experiment, is better. Always seems to be shit. So this is referring to when we were talking last week regarding Sony's experiments with PlayStation Eye, PlayStation... those kind of experiments. So, yeah. I don't really care that much what will come from Microsoft. PC games aside, not really big on Xbox. As far as Xbox goes, yeah, it would be a PC app if I can get anything related to Xbox. PC over Xbox. Nintendo, I think, will be a letdown. The only good thing that will come from Nintendo would be regarding the next Zelda.
Oh, Nintendo was today, weren't they?
Tomorrow.
Oh, they're tomorrow
morning. And all they're going to talk about is Zelda. Because they have a long stream that's going to talk about nothing but that game.
Makes sense.
Yep, because that's all they have. Right now. I think with all of it, there will be a lot of hype for everything. Microsoft, there's hype for their hardware, some hype. Sony is just, everyone's
yeah.
melted. And Nintendo, well, Nintendo has dumped all their eggs in the Zelda basket this year. So.
Sony, everybody walked out of the Sony, you know, their heads are exploding.
Their heads have melted and been like, Sony, we
oh, great Sony,
we
praise you.
We worship you. Well, unless you happen to own like a 4K gaming PC and realize, damn, if only this stuff could be in 4K.
That's me.
Yeah, Nick.
DirectX 12, 4K.
60 frames a second.
But you guys poked fun at me. I swear, if you guys, if you guys got to experience it, you'd be talking the same shit.
But the problem is, I can't afford it right
if
now.
If my thing didn't weigh, if that thing didn't weigh 100 pounds, I would freaking go out of here.
Oh, that's not a 4K TV,
okay,
so never mind.
But it still didn't stop you from playing Uncharted, though, right?
Oh, Uncharted 4 looks gorgeous. But I'm not gonna lie, I was playing that shit. I was like, man, I was like, okay, I understand not being 4K. At least be 60 hertz, like 60 frames per second.
Okay,
all
right.
How did that make a glorified laptop processor game look that good? I don't think they could do much more.
Oh, hell no. What they're able to get out of that hardware is insane.
Like, the only two developers can squeeze just about every ounce out of a little system.
All right, but anyway.
Anyways, next comment is from Hawk. I used to be huge into Xbox. Have an Xbox One that I do play. Had the older ones. But it really seems that there isn't any reason to get a new one. Majority of their games will be on PC, either made for PC as well, or via the Xbox app.
Yeah.
That's exactly it. They're focused on making money off the software and Xbox Live subscriptions. Oh, that's the one thing. I guarantee you eventually they're going to get to the point where to play on PC, they're going to require Xbox Live.
I will just not buy Xbox games anymore at that point, because at that point I'm just like, why do I have to fucking... Excuse the language. Why do I have to freaking pay an Xbox Live subscription to play Forza on my PC? I don't even play online. I just want to drive cars. I'll just buy Project Cars then.
Go back to Avis.
I am not. Okay, I don't know about you, but I can't exactly drive a Camaro
yes,
20 miles an hour.
Best
Avis.
Comeback of the event, or you can just go back to Avis.
I am not allowed to drive a Camaro 120 miles an hour.
Well, you just said I want to drive cars.
Maybe I should be more specific, man. Jeez,
that was amazing.
Oh.
Anyway, yeah.
Seems like a waste to buy the console, like you guys said. Would rather spend the money to upgrade my PC.
Ah, he's a PC guy.
If you're a PC person, absolutely. There's no reason to buy an Xbox.
Yeah,
we're talking about the general public here.
Yeah, if you're a PCP guy, don't buy that stuff. It's bad for you.
Yeah,
oh my god. I don't think Anthony caught that. Because he was about to respond to it, seriously.
I forgot what you even said. I was going to ask, wait, what did you say?
He said if you're a PCP guy.
I wouldn't recommend it. Anyway.
But that's a comment.
Yeah, I don't have much to say about this because I'm not really big on Xbox, so I don't have much to say about
it. I used to be, but now it's like, I don't even... What's...
I'm just ready for Forza 4K.
Every time I look at Microsoft, I just kind of feel like they're constantly like not knowing what to do next. Like, they know what to do next, but I kind of feel like they're not exactly tackling the biggest problem here. They're just trying to... It's a rebuilding year.
Yeah.
That's what it seems like. It's like when the team just comes out and says, we're in a rebuilding year. And the Xbox, they're like putting out, and they're talking about an Xbox One S and Project Scorpio, and then their games, a lot of it we actually kind of knew existed or will eventually come out. They're like, you know, it's a rebuilding year. Where Sony just came out and completely just floored everybody with new stuff we never heard of before.
Yeah.
That we actually get excited about. Like, it's not just a case of, you know, here's some new stuff. No, it's a case of, here's some new stuff and you like it because, like, in the case of God of War, obviously, like, a lot of PlayStation people played a God of War game.
Yeah, that was... That
a lot
was
of people
their...
played Resident Evil. A lot of people know who Spider-Man is. A lot of people, you know, like Star Wars.
Yeah, it's just...
Sony kind of has this stuff that clicks a lot of people, whereas Microsoft's like, Indie! You know, a few happy days, and I'm just like...
Oh, Bronx is jet happy.
He's happy about that, but I'm just like, my kind of style.
Yeah, I mean, granted, there are some good indie games. I'm not going to say there isn't. There are. I don't know. It's just a wait and see thing. Like, that's pretty much what Microsoft is like. Oh, just wait and see.
We're in a rebuilding year.
Yeah,
we're in a rebuilding year.
Sony was like, yeah, here you go. You wanted it. You got it. It's like
I felt like the Shrine had a lot to do with why they didn't talk about a lot of things. They just showed video after video after video, which was great.
Yeah, and that stage was pretty awesome too.
Yeah, I think that's why they didn't talk very much.
But wow, man, still, I'm still blown away from that God of War intro. Yeah,
that was a great way to start.
I don't think you could. I don't think you could have opened up or reveal a game any better.
Yeah,
that was amazing. That was perfect.
All right.
Because considering I love grand epic symphonic music, like that God of War theme basically encapsulized all of that.
Yeah,
and I'm like that. You can't do better.
You want to do the spiel?
Yes. So. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, follow us on twitch.tv/thegameraccess. If you would like to donate to us, we have a donate button under the Twitch player. Be sure to check out our other shows. 60 Minute Access this coming week, I think, is either Odin's Fear Left Our Seer or Mirror's Edge Catalyst, which is a game that you will get very sick on.
Yeah,
imagine the VR. Imagine
oh
that.
My god.
I forgot Mirror's Edge even came out because I knew it was they were making it. I just didn't know it came out.
Yeah, play that on VR.
Check out Super Mega Single Playtime of The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time, where they just finished the I forgot what dungeon they finished. The creepy shadow dungeon.
Yeah
that's what they finished.
Check out the comics about these.
Yeah, check out their latest comic about the courage that is Hyrule's army. Yeah. Let's see what else. Playing God. This past week it was Conker from Conker's Bad Fur Day. Recommendation, there's a bit of an obscene gesture thrown by Conker. So, just throwing that out there. Check out Bronson's Soapbox. This his latest soapbox is on ranking his favorite Warcraft expansions, all of them including Vanilla WoW. And I think that covers our show lineup. Obviously, you guys. Oh, the Gamecast. Listen to Gamecast where they also predicted E3. But they will have a new podcast. And obviously, you guys are listening to Unscripted Access and made it through this 2-hour show.
Thank you very much, folks.
More to come.
Oh, yeah.
Yep, more to come. Thanks, guys. Thanks for listening.
Later.
Peace.